Amarillo, San Antone, any old place I call my home, I gotta go. I got Texas in my soul. Dallas, Fort Worth, San Angelo, Houston, Austin.
It's an old-fashioned Southwest Conference rivalry turned Big 12 event that you don't want to miss. Why? The standings in this league will indicate it to you. Iowa State and BYU at the top have been runaway freight trains, but the margins for error are razor thin. And that's where Texas Tech, with only one conference loss, albeit a week ago, enters into the equation. And for TCU, a team coming off its biggest road win of the season. Hi again, everyone. Tim Brando by my side, Devin Gardner. You'll hear from Josh Sims a little bit later on. You know, if you think about where we are in this league at this stage, it's good to find out who you are. Sadly for Texas Tech, they got an idea of what they are without Taj Brooks, and it's not very good. They've got him healthy now, and they're optimistic.
Yeah, not having Taj Brooks is not what you want, and last week it was very clear that anything can happen in this conference, but today they have to make sure that they start with Taj Brooks. I know that this offense is great at passing the football down the field, but I think that he needs to be the catalyst for them to get a win, and you remember, Tim, they are in complete control of their own destiny. As bad as it looked for Red Raider fans a week ago, they are in complete control. So if they handle their business, they'll get everything they want.
Indeed. Now, on the flip side, you know, when you watch TCU play, you think, okay, there's really a lot of power in that offense if the quarterback can protect the ball. And lately, Josh Hoover has done just that.
Yes, he has. And he had one of those streaks that you just do not want to have, where he had three consecutive games with at least two turnovers. And then they had a bye week. And they fixed some things, his footwork, his decision-making, his discipline with his eyes. And he remedied some of those turnovers. And I think that he's moving forward, and he wants to build on what he was able to do a week ago. And he has the perfect opportunity today.
All right. It is time now for our progressive game countdown as the Horned Frogs make their way up. It's brought to you by Progressive. Aaron Morton, he needs to be converting in the air while Taj Brooks is his safety net. And the Horned Frogs are hoping for another big day from Hoover and their defense like they had a week ago. Josh Sims is coming up next. Welcome you back. The weather today, absolutely perfect. 81 degrees, no wind to speak of, and down on the sidelines, here's Josh Sims.
Well, following last week's head-scratching loss at the hands of Baylor, Texas Tech head coach Joey McGuire said he met with several players individually. He said the most impactful meetings came with Jacob Rodriguez and C.J. Baskerville. He said of Rodriguez, the message was simple. We've been in worse situations in the past. Everything is in front of us. We take care of business. We went out. We're in the Big 12 championship game. As far as Baskerville, he said, we don't need to simplify things. Cut us loose. Let us play free. We will figure it out on defense. So for McGuire, the message is now simple. Tough teams respond. Let's see if this Texas Tech team can respond here today.
No doubt about it. TCU won the toss, Josh. And because they anticipate that you'll have to score more than 13 to win this game against an offense as explosive as Texas Tech, they decided to receive. Reese Burkhart will kick it away. And Jordan Bailey is back deep. And this one will go through for a touchback. And the Horned Frogs will take over at the 25, and you can bet that they hope to get out of the gates quickly and have an opportunity to score and keep the football away from this Texas Tech offense. Hoover, as we mentioned, just a sophomore, but a young man that's coming along, and some of those interceptions he threw early were hard luck picks, the kind that ricochet off receivers or maybe thrown into traffic on a quick slant. He's kept his confidence about him. The big key will be his playing within himself and letting those receivers of his, guys like Savion Williams and J.P. Richardson and Jack Besh, get the job done for them. They'll start with a little teacup formation down at the bottom of your screen, or a diamond, if you will, and go in that direction, but it's nothing doing for Richardson. If the name sounds familiar in these parts, it should. He's the son of Bucky Richardson, the former Oiler, Cowboy, and Texas A&M QB. Nothing doing on first down. So it's second and 10. You see the motion. And here goes on the stretch play and making his move, Savion Williams, who they will line up as a running back many times. They want to get him the ball as often as they can, Devin.
Yeah, absolutely. He starts on that quarterback. He's just the old Wildcat, and it's a big old Wildcat. I'm just telling you, this guy is 6'5", 225 pounds, and he played quarterback in high school, and it was a lot of this. So they thought that they could get a little bit of that run game going by putting him at that position and allowing him to hit the home runs, and you can see he gains 9 on his first carry.
That gives them a 3rd and 1. They're 44% in converting on 3rd down. And it got a little bit easier after that play. And once again, Savion's back there. Take it to the left side and cuts it back up for a 1st down. Picks up 2. And Chapman Lewis, the free safety, comes up to make contact. Number 25, they're happy to have him back in the lineup.
And for TCU, that looked like the old student body left, where you get guys pulling. You got 3 or 4 guys out in front of a big running back. A nice job and a nice call by offensive coordinator Kendall Browse.
First and 10 just beyond the 35, and that's a crossing pattern that's caught to a very large target, Drake Dabney. And Chapman Lewis, 25, was with him step for step to bring him down, a gain of 6.
Yeah, just a shallow cross, and they almost leak a guy, Harvey Dyson III, number 33 in white, into the passing lane, and a nice job of Hoover avoiding that and getting it to his big tight end.
On 2nd and 4, power running right up the gut. Well done by Trent Battle, a young man that missed about the first 4 to 5 weeks of this season. They're happy to be getting him back into the lineup. Junior out of Daphne, Alabama, a gain of 5.
Yeah, a lot of why Savion Williams is the guy getting the carries in the backfield is because they were without Trent Battle, and with him being back, he's going to get a lot of the load, and he's going to be productive for this TCU offense.
This is a Horned Frogs team that got a lot out of their open date, and they are hoping that that win last week will give them some confidence. That's just a beautiful move by Besh, the LSU transfer, who looked more like a tight end at the start of his career and now is a svelte wideout that was inside, playing outside now for Kendall Briles. 2nd and 2 after a gain of 8. Once again, Trent Battle should have enough for the 1st down. Move the chains at the Red Raiders.
If TCU can continue to get those positive plays on 1st down, it's going to really bode well. And on that first play by Besh, I mean, that's a regular out route, but the route detail is so important. And that's why these TCU wide receivers create so much separation. They spend a lot of time using details to make sure their routes are perfect so that they're open for their quarterback.
Well, the Red Raiders now see TCU's drive continuing, and the ball's on their side of the field at the 43 on 1st down. Bootleg action. Hoover on that shallow cross one more time to Dabney. And one of 3 tight ends you'll see. DJ Rogers primarily would be the 2nd guy that's coming in there. John Curry, number 6, the linebacker with the tackle. But they're getting good gains on 1st down. Don't get behind the chains. Looking at 2nd and 5, 2nd and 3s, which is what they face right here. Again, they go Wildcat. Savion, look at that nimble footing. Spin, baby, spin, and take it in.
There isn't a ton of space for Savion to get through, but somehow he finds his way through, and then he gets on a one-on-one opportunity, and it's a spin away from him and all the way to the end zone. His ability with the football in his hands is what the coaching staff said. We just need to get him the football. They get it to him, and he's in the end zone.
35 yards. That is the longest touchdown rushing that they have had all season long. 32 was his previous high, and it is 7-0. Just a remarkable touchdown. We welcome those of you on Fox that were enjoying our big noon matchup. Ohio State trying to and surviving Nebraska. Here, TCU just moments ago took the lead 7-0 on their opening drive. They got it done primarily on the ground, and we'll show you that in a moment. Tim Brando, Devin Gardner by my side. You'll hear from Josh Sims on the sidelines a little bit later. But boy, oh boy, what a first drive and touchdown for Savion out of the Wildcat.
I mean, it's kind of what we thought we would see, and Savion Williams is a star in the making, and he stayed, he wanted another opportunity, and now they're using him and getting the football to him as much as possible. And if you're just joining us, you missed something already.
Well, Jake Jolivet and Dustin Dinty, our crew, will have it for you momentarily after the kick as Texas Tech awaits for their opportunity on their first series. This crowd is jacked up. Their team playing perhaps their best game of the season defensively in their win against Utah. And Texas Tech coming off a porous performance at home. Admittedly, Joey McGuire, their coach, said, look, this is, we laid an egg. We flat out were not ready, we're not prepared, and did not perform well against Baylor a week ago. But this is their chance to right the ship. Tech is 0-2 when the opponent has scored first. And we had the first game against Washington State and, of course, the Baylor game a week ago. Not really sure what this conversation piece is about between our referee and Sonny Dykes. Now, Limmerman will be kicking it away as play gets back in order momentarily. Not really sure what that stoppage was about, and we're not being informed either what it was about. Jordan Brown is back in safety awaiting the kick from Kyle Limmerman. Big 12 has been topsy-turvy all year long. There comes Brown. And he is racked up just past the 15-yard line and pushed back. 18-yard return. Let's go back to the touchdown, Devin.
You got to take a look right here. Center, tackle, pulling around, up through. And this big, talented wide receiver who's doubling as a running back has the vision of a running back, and that's why they have him back there. And then the spin is just his talent with the football in his hands. And it's deuces to the end zone. Even though he's wearing number 3.
Thrice is nice.
Yeah.
Now Texas Tech with their opportunity, and they can score in bunches, as you well know. Baron Morton out of the shotgun. Delivers it to Josh Kelly. And Morton, young man that's put a lot on his own shoulders, junior out of Eastland, Texas, struggled last week, 3 picks, 3 touchdowns and an interception, but was playing from behind the entire game. It was a hard luck afternoon in Lubbock. Now he goes with an out route. And that's Caleb Douglas on the receiving end. Well defended by Jadarius Broughton.
Caleb Douglas is a guy who's come on late, right? He's starting to really find his footing for this Texas Tech Raider football, Red Raider football team. And that was an opportunity for him to get one-on-one coverage. He goes and steps on his toes and makes sure he gets back to the quarterback. A nice throw by Baron Morton.
Jatravis goes back over, does Broughton, and single coverage. And here goes Taj. This is the difference maker. He's a home run hitter, and he's a record breaker every time he touches the ball. That's Amdi Obiazor that makes the stop, and we'll be calling his name quite often during the course of this game. There's a crossing pattern that's caught by Douglas up to midfield for the first down. Bud Clark, big time safety out of Alexandria Senior High School in Louisiana.
Safety comes down because of the run fake. You throw it right behind his head. That's the paradigm of what RPO looks like. Run pass option.
Brooks, who has no problem carrying it 25 or more times in any game, stopped by Devin Deal. Devin, number 11, and his brother Marcus are in the starting lineup up front for this TCU team. Tymon Mitchell will also play, obviously. Cooper McDonald is out, not able to go for the Horned Frogs today. So Devin, number 11, is an edge rusher right there at the bottom of your screen. 2nd and 7, Brooks in motion. And they'll give it to him, and he looked upfield and just dropped it. That one was going to go quite a ways, and he just kept his eyes on the ball.
The goal for Texas Tech is to have this tempo, right? When you have tempo, the defense starts to scramble, right? The linebackers, the safeties, and it gives you an opportunity to hit some throws down the field. Now you would love for Taj Brooks to catch that ball because he's got a lot of room in front of him, but this tempo is really going to hurt. But the thing is, you can't go tempo and get right off the field. So this third down is very important.
Zach Kittley, who once had a great quarterback, now in the league, now running this Texas Tech offense, dials up that to Josh Kelly, and TCU was ready for it. And it'll be fourth down and a punt formation coming up for the Red Raiders.
Yeah, Tim, this is the one thing that you can't do, right? You go fast, and then it's third down, you don't convert, and your defense seemingly is right back on the field after the TCU Horned Frogs already scored a touchdown. So they're going to punt this ball away, and their defense is going to have to come out and stand tall.
Jack Burgess will get it off at around his 43. Boy, they were coming after it. I don't know how they missed that. Richardson with a fair catch inside the 10-yard line. A 40-yard boo lead by 7.
Win or tie the turnover battle. So it's really conducive for them to not turn the ball over today.
They go out of the shotgun. Trent Battle, who was in a slot, now moves behind. And he'll take it right where he was lined up. But Texas Tech really stayed home. That was outstanding penetration by C.J. Baskerville, the senior from North Richland Hills, Texas, a smart player who stayed home, just as Josh Sims described to us as we opened our game.
Yeah, Baskerville's really played well, and it's mostly in the pass game, but you see him coming out of the middle of the field and coming down and making a play.
Okay, checking it down. And that pass is taken by D.J. Rogers, the backup tight end. He juggled it momentarily. Got out for a little bit of yardage, but not much. It'll be third down and long coming up. So give them a yard, and it's third and 9.
Third down and long is an opportunity to get TCU in this Hoover, the quarterback, into a drop-back scenario where you can show one picture and then change to another in the back end.
Pressure. Hoover feels it. Now lets it fly, and it's caught. What a pass and catch. J.P. Richardson just spread eagle. Flew his body out there. They pick up a Baker's dozen and a first down.
That is a nice catch, and an even better job by Hoover to evade the rush and then get the ball out baseball style, turn it into double play.
Yep.
And a nice catch.
Well, an old first baseman like Freddie Freeman, when playing, would love that from a shortstop when turning after the shortstop went into the hole for one. That pass was intended for Jack Besh. It's incomplete. Second down and 10.
And that's a miscommunication that you usually don't see when it's Hoover going to Besh. Besh knows exactly where he wants him to be, and so he runs a hitch route, but Hoover throws an out route. Just a miscommunication there.
There's Sonny Dykes, 2 years removed from one of the real miracle runs of college football in recent memory, with the help of Max Duggan, who was a Heisman finalist, got all the way to the national championship game. He's trying to bring some glory back in this second half of the season as he watches Trent Battle get ahead for about a yard or two, and that is all. Blake Nowell, 87, is checking into the game. Excellent read by Ben Roberts, the linebacker, the Mike linebacker, to make that stop. Well, they're facing, after just a pickup of a yard, another third down and 9.
On third down, McAllister has become very reliable for Hoover.
88 is the number, and there's the pressure off the edge. An absolute sandwich that time. Esters was coming in, Charles Esters, and he collaborated with nickelbacker Brendan Jordan, number 7.
Yeah, just coming down right into your screen in between for a nice job, and it's a party at the quarterback. They meet and sandwich Hoover to get him to the ground. That's exactly what Texas Tech needed after their offense went off the field.
Until that point, they had gotten positive yardage on first down. Didn't happen in that series. Looks like a marker down, at least running into the kicker, maybe even roughing the kicker, could be the call back at the 5-yard line. That was Esther's first sack, by the way, but hold everything. Our referee will tell us the rest of the story here. That's Stephen Barron, our white hat today. Our replay official is Brad Van Vark.
They're going to give him running in. I think they're going to give him running into the kicker there, Tim.
I thought it was running into the kicker.
They sold out. They dove over, and he kind of just falls into the kicker there. So not going to go roughing. Just touches the tip of his toe.
Yep.
Tip of the big toe is what he touched. I don't think you can give him 15 for that.
Well.
Running into the kicker, defense. That 5-yard penalty will be enforced. We'll replay fourth down.
So we'll have to do this one more time.
Yeah, for TCU, they want to get a better kick, right? Because that ball kind of went backspin back
it
into
did.
Their own territory. So smart decision by Coach Sonny Dykes to make sure they punt this ball away again. The only thing I worry about is the old adage is nothing good happens on a re-kick, right?
Yeah.
And it's usually for the kicking team, right? So you want to make sure this ball is nice and high, so it has to be a fair catch so that nothing bad happens on the return.
Only a 32-yard punt for Ethan Cross, so you know the Tasmania Australia native would love to have this do-over that he's about to get. Albeit we're as close as we are to Hogan's Alley, where the Colonial is played. We do have mulligans in football, and this one's even worse. Off the side of his foot.
I think I said it.
I think you did.
Nothing good happens on a re-kick, and that is even worse than the kick before.
I was about to say, I'm not sure in all my years that I had heard that adage.
I got you covered.
North Texas, some of the best steak that you'll ever have. We had some last night, courtesy of the Grace. If you're ever in downtown Fort Worth, that's a great spot to visit. Morton on the check down to Taj Brooks, who's really good coming out of the backfield. In addition to being an outstanding back that could carry it 25 times, he could catch passes too. Only a yard that time, though. Well read defensively by the TCU defense.
Yeah, and the reason why it's read so well, because they have guys in the space already. They play cover two, something they don't do a whole bunch of. But when you play cover two, you have your corners up in the flats at about 5 yards. So when that ball is caught, they're right there to make that play.
Obi Izar was all over that play. On second and nine. Boy, he reads and adjusts so well. His patience as a running back has really become his greatest attribute. And he talked to us at length about that yesterday when we met at their hotel over by Jerry World in Arlington.
Yeah, I mean, it's so impressive to watch him. Watch him get the ball and kind of just survey, wait, and then burst and find his way through. And it's so hard to judge for a defensive backfield or linebackers or even the defensive line. And that's why he has so much success. And that's why they set up this third and short.
12 personnel, two tight ends now in the game.
Looks like it's zero coverage.
And it's a quick out. And it is taken by Mason Tharp, one of those tight ends. But Clark comes over. And now, as the whistle blows, the contact continues.
This is something that the Red Raiders love to do. They love to throw these screens that look like pass plays, right? The ball is caught behind the line of scrimmage. But all of these receivers can go make blocks. And it starts at the point of attack. You make that block by Douglas, and then you allow your tight end to get the first down. And now they can continue this drive.
Bud Clark will just not let go. If you say play to the echo of the whistle,
oh, yeah,
they're talking about Bud. Don't call me Jadarius, his given name, surname, Clark.
Boy, was he fun to talk
to. He really was. Boy, were they keyed on Brooks there. I mean, Obi Izar, who's now already made four tackles in this game, was right on top of Taj Brooks. Nothing doing. Leads TCU with 6.5 tackles for losses and 2.5 sacks. Has had 11 or more tackles twice this year. So second down and 10.
Right now you got middle open. A split safety defense where you have space in the middle to get the ball there.
Out of the gun, Brooks. Again, outstanding work up front with the undercut by Jamel Johnson, the strong safety. Andy Avalos is a name you'll remember. Former head coach of Boise State. Had them in the Mountain West Championship game just 2 years ago. What a pickup he's been as a defensive coordinator for Sonny Dykes.
Yeah, and he hears you talking about him. He's patting himself on the back to make sure everybody knows, yes, that's me. I'm the good coordinator he's talking about.
He knows when the accolades are coming. Here's Morton flushed from the pocket into the end zone, and that's an inadvertent trip.
Yeah.
There will be no flag this time. Roy Aiken was the intended receiver. Lamarion James 6 is there. That's a trip that was inadvertent.
And I love the no call. You get Aiken, who tries to go, and then he sees his quarterback starting to move, and so he tries to run away, and their feet just get caught up, and he falls down. So I love that there's no call by the referee there.
Gino Garcia will try from 38. He is 10 of 10 on field goal tries this year. Make it 11 of 11. It's a good number if you're a betting man.
Houston, Austin.
And I'm your play-by-play announcer from Northwest Louisiana. Some believe should be annexed into East Texas. Hasn't been yet.
East side of Detroit.
80 total players from the Dallas-Fort Worth metropolitan area. I got to tell you, it is just so much fun to come back over here. Fort Worth is not Dallas, and I'm going to tell you, it's a big little town. It's got all the amenities of a major city.
Everybody's so nice here.
They're so nice.
Yeah.
And this will be brought out to the 25 after the fair catch by Jordan Bailey. TCU has the 4-point lead. Savion Williams took it. Shout out to my buddy Joe Davis. Freddie, meet Gibby. One of the great calls you'll ever hear from any broadcaster. Joe's still a young guy. That was marvelous. Enjoyed it. And we'll have many, many more between now and the end of the Yankees-Dodgers series. Savion Williams wide open down the seam. He's got one on the ground. An angle, but no, he's got one in the air.
So they've handed it to him. Now he lines up at running back and creates a mismatch. This is a wide receiver on a linebacker. He can't cover him. He doesn't have a chance, and he's right through the middle. And once he catches it, he's got that wide receiver speed all the way to the end zone.
Career-long 75-yard touchdown reception. And for TCU, their longest play of this season. And I got to tell you, folks, because my partner, while we were in a break, said, if you see Savion Williams at wide receiver, let me have it, Timmy B. He was going in that direction, and I was too busy giving a shout-out to Joe D.
Joe Davis was very good.
He was very good. But you were spot on, and it was the perfect time to throw it to him after he'd been lining up in a wildcat.
100%. And when you see Texas Tech trying to play man-to-man coverage and they don't adjust to him in the backfield, it's very important to know that he gets to match up with a linebacker, and it's just not going to happen for Texas Tech if that's what they plan on doing. The thing you have to do is they have to have a spotter, somebody on the sideline to know when is Savion Williams in the game, because that's not a running back, that's more of a wide receiver. You need to have your personnel to match on defense.
So in just one quarter of this game, Williams has TCU's largest rushing play of the year, 35, and their largest play of any kind, 75, in the air.
Tim, I mean, obviously, I raved about him all the way up to this game, but seeing him at practice and seeing him take those wildcat snaps, his acceleration, his size, I mean, he is exactly what you want in a football player, and he is putting it on full display here today.
So that's four touches, right?
And two touchdowns. That's half.
Yep.
Right? So half the time he touches the ball, he scores.
Here comes Jordan Brown. Just shy of the 30-yard line. Series games that year in 95. It's something special. And Freddie Freeman, the former Brave, came up big for the Dodger Blue last night. Here's Taj Brooks on a stretch play. And he gets out past the 30, near the 35-yard line, before being ushered out. Pickup of 6, second and 4. Johnny Hodges with that neck roll of his at middle linebacker, former Navy star that's come over to be with this team, came over in the 2021 season, has been a stalwart at that position. Second and 4. Morton on the out route. It's caught. And it's a first down to Coy Aiken.
I mean, just great timing here by Barrymore. And watch the ball release before Aiken has even turned around. When you have that type of timing and precision, there's no way you can stop it. A nice pickup and a first down for Texas Tech.
Again, double tight end look. Last time they went to this formation, Tharp, number 80, the tight end at the bottom of the screen, got the pass. Here's Brooks. And TCU Rick run all the way on that. And he stopped a yard, maybe two, behind the line of scrimmage. Jamel Johnson, the strong safety, coming up. And we're coming to the end of the quarter at a time when the Red Raiders need to answer with good field position. They're going to say he lost about a half yard, so basically no gains. Zach Kittley looks on. He needs to dial up some big-time plays.
And that's a huge win for TCU's defense because they were in too high. Yeah, and anybody knows, when you're in too high, there's not enough guys in the box, so you should be able to run the ball if you're the Red Raiders, and they weren't able to do that, like you said, and they almost gave him a loss on that play.
That's tops in the Big 12, third in the country. Tough sledding so far, though. Seven carries for 25 yards. And that crossing pattern goes incomplete. And Morton faces another third and long, third down and 10 coming up. This is a very important drive, albeit still very early in the game. TCU's offense is in high gear, and Zach Kittley wants to see the same from his. They are 2 out of 4 on third down so far.
John Carlos Miller, the second right here, a guy who they love to get the football to.
Another one of those tight ends that they're utilizing. Stays in the block here. Morton's pass. The out route complete, but short of the first down yardage. Good recognition again by Channing Canada.
Yeah, I mean,
as
that's
Coy Aiken was on the receiving end.
It's a really nice throw by Barrymore, and it's on time, and that's a nice route by Coy Aiken, but you expect Coy Aiken to take it a few steps further so that you can get the first down right. You run that play short, and now you have to punt the football away.
Burgess will punt it away. Last time, he barely got it off as TCU was in a total punt block situation. This one is well done. End over end, J.P. Richardson cradles it for the fair catch, a 40-yard boot. They'll start just outside their 10. Pacific Life game summary sponsored by Pacific Life. Creating financial security for more than 160 years. You could call it the Savion Williams show, couldn't
yeah,
you?
Yeah. I mean, watching him on film, it was really impressive, right? Jump balls, different things like that. But now you're seeing him in this running back role, and they're just using matchup. You got to give a lot of credit to offensive coordinator Kendall Browse of really showing what this kid is capable of. And since he's playing running back, even though he's a receiver, how about some big running backs of the past? Eddie George, Brandon Jacobs, and Derrick Henry. I mean, he's taller than those guys, but maybe not as much girth because he is still playing wide receiver. But he's really having an effect on this game from the running back position.
I don't think there's any doubt when he's on the field, he's the best athlete. Cam Cook is coming to the game now in the backfield. And pressure coming. Ball is on the ground. Texas Tech might be in position to get it, and they do. The pressure was coming off the edge by Harvey Dyson. He forced the fumble.
And just watch him come off the edge and use his speed, and then he karate chops the hands down to get after the quarterback. A really nice job by him of getting those hands down, bending flat, and getting to the quarterback to get the ball out. We talked about it early. Turning the ball over is a reason that TCU is not having the perfect season that they would want to have, and there's another turnover. TCU gives the ball away.
First fumble. Recovery of the year for Tech. And he also stripped it and recovered it. So Dyson with both the hit and the recovery.
Is that a twofer? You call it a
twofer? That's
one,
a
huh?
Twofer. Almost like a scoop and score, but not quite. What a I mean, they have given pressure.
Actually, that's a threefer.
Yeah.
Sack.
Yeah.
Forced fumble and fumble recovery.
Absolutely.
How about that?
No doubt about it.
I mean, he wears number 33, so it's only right.
You know, he gave it all he had. Here's an interesting formation. Look at this. A quad down at the bottom of your screen. Gordon's pass in the corner. That's outstanding man coverage that time. Micah Hudson, the intended receiver, And Javon McIver, number 20, was absolutely blanketing him.
Yeah, and Michael Hudson is a young guy, and he'll learn as he continues to grow. He's a true freshman, so you see him kind of rush to the back of the end zone. He has to understand the quarterback has to catch the ball from the shotgun, and so he has a little more time to spend time at the line of scrimmage and create space that way. He moves a little too quick, and it sets up this third down here for Texas Tech.
Yeah, and I'm going to be curious if they have to go on fourth down, what they do, because this is a huge opportunity. You'd think they're thinking six without a doubt. Morton. Incomplete. And again, a little hesitation on his part. I'm a little curious as to why Taj Brooks was not involved in that play. And they're gonna look for possibly. Are they gonna go for three here? Looks like they may. Nope. I believe they. Yep, they're gonna kick it. Well, that is a huge win for the TCU defense.
Yeah, you can see what they tried to do. They tried to create that pick play because it's man-to-man, but a really nice job of TCU of running over the top to make that play.
Burkhart. Oh, it's a fake. There he goes for the corner. Touchdown, Reese Burkhart. That's why they chose to take the three. A little something in Joey McGuire's hip pocket.
Wow.
How do you do?
Oh, yeah. I was wondering when it was coming. I mean, if that's not a how do you do moment, I don't know what is.
Well, you know they had worked on that for a while, right?
What a call. What a call. And you know it has to go up the chain.
Yeah.
Joey McGuire allows that to be called and a touchdown is scored. Very nice.
And we should have picked up on it because it wasn't Garcia who was 11 for 11 in field goal tries, but Burkhart does handle the kickoffs,
yeah,
and occasionally will come out for extra points. So they were, you know what he was practicing all week long in Lubbock,
God.
Texas, right?
I mean, look at him get the edge just like a pro.
How about the tight end, John Carlos Miller with the block?
Second, 14 to 10, our score here. After that man right there, Reese Burkhart, took it in on a magnificent fake field goal try that brings back a lot of memories in this sport, and now he boots it through the end zone. Devin, take us through that.
Yeah, I mean, it's as good as a job as it is by Burkhart. This play doesn't happen without John Carlos Miller right there, who makes the play, and he has to make sure he gets in the way of Hodges, number 57, and let it run here. You're going to see he sneaks right through, and if he doesn't make this block, then Burkhart never gets into the end zone, and the play is for naught. So an outstanding job by John Carlos Miller. For people at home, he usually wears a different number, but he's wearing 18 today. And we may see him in some obvious pass situations on defense as well.
In Les Miles' national championship year in 2007, Colt David ran that play on September 22nd against Steve Spurrier and Florida.
Yeah.
And that helped them get the win, LSU, that year. They won the national title with two losses, as it turned out. Here goes Savion one more time. He has been a human highlight film today. And a marker is down, so hold everything back near the line of scrimmage. He's smiling from ear to ear, and why not? Thrown in an area where you expect clipping or holding.
Holding. Offense, number 9. 10-yard penalty enforced from the previous spot. First down.
Drake Dabney, the tight end, is tagged with that foul. Take a look at the top of your screen here.
And when it's at the point of attack, you're always going to see it. You're going to see his hands are inside to start. And yeah, when he gets thrown off, he holds on. You know, if you're a TCU fan, you're saying, what? And if you're a Texas Tech fan, you're applauding. So I think it could go either way. They did call him for a hold. He did grab a hold when he was getting thrown off.
After the penalty, first and 20, a quick pitch towards the boundary for Williams. And he gets popped out. He's touching the ball a lot today, both as a runner as well as a receiver. That time he was hammered by Braylon Lux, number 0, outstanding corner.
Let's listen to this collision. That is aggressive stuff.
Yeah.
I mean, that's a big guy you're coming down to hit, and that's a nice job of trying to get low. And somehow Savion Williams at 6'5" gets lower than Lux.
And Lux, all 5'8", 185 of him, got him with a shoulder. That pass is airmailed and incomplete.
thrown in the direction of Eric McAllister, a junior transfer from Boise State.
That's a big, long throw for Hoover from the opposite hash outside on the comeback, trying to throw it on time, and he throws it a little too high for McAllister to go get it.
Well, Hoover started 6 out of 6, only 1 out of 3 since. But whenever he's targeted number 3, he's been in good shape. Besh has a catch, as does J.P. Richardson. And they go with 4 wides and a tight end here.
And there is J.P. Richardson, a guy who moves the chains.
And it looks like we've got a timeout taken by TCU.
It's a third down play, and I don't love that Savion Williams is off the field.
Yeah.
Right? Maybe that's going to be the adjustment here with this timeout.
TCU has called their first timeout of the half.
Points and possessions are on a premium today.
100%.
It's the 3 P's at work when we come back.
Saucy Nugs, all right now.
I think I called them that once. I'm not sure they were from Wendy's, though.
So the adjustment is Savion Williams is on the field, right?
Yeah.
He wasn't on the field.
Right.
They called timeout. He's on the field outside the top of your screen.
Third down and a long way, and there's the pressure again. Texas Tech delivering the goods against Josh Hoover. And it's coming from the edge from Braylon Rigsby, the right outside linebacker. And in addition to that, some strong help up the middle as well.
Yeah, and the thing is, they have a well-designed play on both ends. For Texas Tech, they do a nice job of dropping enough guys to cover everybody up. And for TCU, you have a check down in Savion Williams that you just don't get to, so it ends in a punt.
Beautiful punt with a fair catch made by Jordan Brown. And let's go down to Josh Sims. Josh?
Well, Tim, you talked about the fact that every time Taj Brooks makes a play, he's putting himself in the record books. Well, last fall, he actually interned with the athletic office. He would work on game notes. He would track record watches. When I asked him about it, he said, yeah, I use that as motivation. I would see people and where they are in the record books, knowing I was closing in on them, and then next game I knew what I needed to do to catch them. So how about that, the intern using that as a way to motivate him on the field?
Yeah, he's
forward thinking.
Yeah, and as great running backs go, they know who came before them.
Yeah. And for him, he's got a lot of those guys in his phone.
Sure does.
We found out yesterday.
Byron Hansport, of course, an outstanding back in Texas Tech history. He's hearing those footsteps as that out pattern is caught by Caleb Douglas right in front of James, Lamarion James, the senior from Norfolk, Virginia. Gain of 11 on a first down.
Again, outstanding timing and precision by Baron Morton. He gets to his drop, hitches and throws the ball before his receiver's looking, and so it's indefensible.
Play fake to Brooks. He's going for the home run hit. Down the sideline. It is caught. It is Douglas. Lamarion James with him, but that's 43 yards. And boy, did he drop this in the bucket.
What an outstanding throw. And Carlo, he doesn't even leave a lot of space on the sideline, but that ball drops in perfectly for a first down.
Touchdown, Taj Brooks. His 9th of the season.
You got the Red Raiders. Well, this thing parks like the Red Sea, and Taj Brooks just essentially almost walks right into the end zone. There's nobody there. Touchdown, Red Raiders.
Davion Carter, 56, the right guard, with a pancake block to seal the fate of TCU's defense there. And Brooks trots in. It all began, though, with this perfect pass. I mean, absolutely perfect from Morton. Right into the arms of Caleb Douglas.
They said he started the season slow, but he's really getting his footing. He's got it now, and you know the running back that has their footing for sure. It is the big fella, Taj Brooks.
And Reese Burkhardt, who has one of those scores, will kick it away on that fake field goal to help turn this baby around. Well, talk about momentum changes. We've seen them. That TCU fumble with 14-10 left in the second has completely shifted this game. From this point forward, the game changed.
Yeah, I mean, it's been big play after big play for Texas Tech. And remember, the keys that I had were you can't allow touchdowns to be scored when your defense is on the field. Well, you're really going to have a good opportunity to win this football game when your defense is taking the ball away, which is what they did. They're playing really good football as opposed to the way they played a week ago. Yeah. Raider fans, I'm sure, are happy to see Coach DeRuiter's defense playing this way.
Yeah, Tim DeRuiter's got to be the happiest guy on that sideline.
Oh,
right,
man,
now.
We talked to him yesterday, and he's just imploring that his guys just figure it out and get to the quarterback, and they've done that.
Jeremy Payne just into the game. Totes it ahead for 9 yards. Think about it. That TCU fumble with 14-10 left in the second shifted this game. TCU up 14-3 at that time.
Yeah.
Now just 3 minutes, 26 later, Texas Tech is up 17-14. And there goes Payne one more time as the Horned Frogs try to get it back in gear on the ground themselves.
And Payne is a true freshman, and he's showing on these two runs really good vision, being able to get in and break arm tackles, and he's picked up nice yardage on two back-to-back runs.
We anticipated this could be a shootout, and it may well be. Checking it down underneath, and they're keeping this kid active. It's Payne one more time. Twice on the ground, one in the air, and this young man is making them pay. Freshman, Hightower High School, Jeremy Payne.
I love to see TCU getting to this tempo to try to keep this Texas Tech defense off balance.
Oh, that pass was dangerous. Ricocheted off of Rogers, the intended receiver, the tight end, but it was thrown into some traffic, and Josh Hoover's had more than his fair share of those kind of tip drill pass picks season.
A big part of the reason this ball isn't caught because he's distracted, right? Jacob Rodriguez does a nice job of collisioning the wide receiver before he gets to the catch point, and then his eyes are a little late to the ball so he can't catch it. And like you said, those are the things that have happened to Hoover where you get a tip ball or a guy's just not ready for the ball just yet and it ends in interception. It's good that ball fell harmlessly to the turf.
Down the sideline, there is the intended receiver, Besh, well defended. That was a superb defensive play by Macho Stevenson.
I mean, outstanding, in position, eyes back to the ball, reach that right hand in and smack it away. What a job by Macho Stevenson. And it's always a nice seatbelt celebration.
From my hometown.
Of course.
Shreveport, Louisiana.
All righty.
In Sportsman's Paradise. It has not been annexed into East Texas yet. Proud Louisiana boy there. This pass is caught. Look at that move. Close to the first down, Jeremy Payne. My goodness, that was a great move to get very, very close to the necessary yardage. A couple of yards shy.
Just a reminder, true freshman.
Yeah.
Right? The moment's not too big. We're in a game where it's the West Texas Championship. He's breaking tackles, protecting the ball. That ball's almost stripped out. No. He's got it tight to the breastplate, and he almost gets the first down.
This has been Payne's drive, no doubt about that.
Texas Tech has called the first timeout of the half. 30-second timeout.
Well, TCU 70% on 75% on fourth down conversions this year, and they're facing one now at fourth and two, and that little extra move by Payne got them close.
Oh yeah, puts them in position to go for it. And my guess, what I would do, it's Savion Williams time. Put them in that wildcat and kind of like they did early in the game, that kind of student body kind of play where you bring three or four guys in front to block, and I just bank on Savion Williams being able to get 2 yards.
There's Tim DeRuiter. We touched on him. And, you know, that guy's been everywhere. Oregon, Cal, one of the most authentic defensive coordinators you'll ever meet. Payne remains in the backfield.
Here we go. Savion Williams, Tom.
Battle has joined him there, number 17. Savion takes it out of the wildcat. They were ready that time. And Texas Tech's D, Tim DeRuiter, will give them a salute when they get to the sidelines after that.
Take a look at number 10, Rodriguez. He's standing right in the middle there. He knows what's coming, and he's going to scrape over and get into the hole and meet Savion Williams there. And it's a tough thing to do, getting that guy to the ground on your own. The cavalry comes, and it's a big stop for Texas Tech.
Loss of two, and the Red Raiders get the ball back. Five big tackles for losses in this game, which has really helped the Red Raider D dictate tempo since the second quarter began. Here's Martin rolling in a bootleg situation, decides to tuck it and run. And Mono Amano in space. Hodge, the Mike linebacker, comes up to make the play, number 57 in black.
Tim, that's really good by Hodge. First of all, he wears a neck roll. Don't let it fool you. He's a really athletic player, and you see him making a play there. But he's guarding the running back, Taj Brooks, and he comes off at perfect timing to make a play on the quarterback. Usually when you leave your man, right, he dumps it right over your head. A nice job of him baiting Baron Morton and then making the play on him.
Second down and nine. Brooks, boy, they are reading and reacting to every opportunity he has. Again, tremendous run support coming from the second level of that TCU defense.
I mean, Abe Kamara just coming blazing into the backfield to make this play. A nice job of first making sure Baron doesn't have it, and then he flies over the top. And a good job by number 11, Devin Deal, who's getting his chance to play a lot because Cooper McDonald's out of setting the edge.
Only 30 yards on 10 carries for Brooks. It hasn't been easy. He does have a touchdown, though. A little curl route, really well defended by LaMarion James, who got burned on that long pass earlier. That time he was right with Caleb Douglas. And they'll have to punt it away on fourth and eight.
Yeah, I mean, he breaks on this ball, and outstanding job of reaching that right glove in there and stopping it from being completed. How about the cornerback play on both sides of the ball these last two possessions?
And by the way, that catch that Caleb Douglas made was a whale of a catch, even in good coverage. That was good single coverage on that play. Just have to tip your cap. And JP takes that and goes down immediately at the 15-yard line. Sonny Dykes, the son of former Texas Tech head coach Spike Dykes, a real legend, one of the most affable men in the sport of college football, graduated from Texas Tech in 93, also played baseball there, an assistant coach from 2000 to 2006, became an air raid guy, wide receiver coach, part of that Mike Leach system, co-offensive coordinator in 05 and 06, and he was off to the races, did a really nice job at Louisiana Tech down the road in Ruston on Interstate 20, and it was on to Cal, where he had, among others, Jared Goff as his quarterback, who's now doing pretty well in Detroit on Sundays.
Decent.
Yep, I'd say so.
Yep, I mean,
at SMU, he turned that program around before leaving to come across town.
Jared Goff's only gone multiple halves without throwing an incompletion.
Pretty good.
I mean, he's so impressive.
In your hometown. Oh, that's a beautiful play fake, and Hoover is out past the 25 to the 28. That's a gain of 12, maybe 13. And he's got the first down.
Yeah, I mean, it's something that you just don't see Hoover do, and it's something that they want him to do. So when you're a defensive end for Texas Tech, you don't expect him to pull that ball out, and that's where there's so much space for him to pick up yardage.
Sonny said he wanted him to run more. He did there. Now, that one was tipped away. That was a tremendous defensive play by Rodriguez, Jacob Rodriguez, number 10. Let's look at that previous play.
Take a look here at Esters. He doesn't expect Hoover to keep the football. He hasn't seen him do it all season, and so he just goes to get the running back, and a nice job of Hoover taking the ball out, protecting it, and making sure he gets yardage.
Trent Battle is checked back in after Jeremy Payne had a wonderful drive before Texas Tech stopped him on downs. Payne carried the load. The way I misspoke earlier, he's not from Shreveport. He's out of Missouri City. That pass was tipped and intercepted. It happened again. Josh Hoover had it happen again. Tipped at the line of scrimmage and picked off. C.J. Baskerville has the interception. It was Rodriguez, number 10, that deflected it.
Man, he's got such good range. He comes down into the box to the left of your screen and just skies up with a great vertical and then catches it all hands. All hands. He's playing defensive back, and he makes this play. Outstanding job by Baskerville.
You know, Rodriguez was in position to tip it, but it was hands of Velcro.
I mean, unbelievable.
By the interceptor, absolutely.
Tim,
Baskerville just grabbed it.
I feel like I have good hands. I'm sure you believe you do, too. That is so hard to, from that close,
no doubt,
to jump up and make that catch all hands.
Yeah, and poor Hoover, he's seen this happen more than just a few times this season. Another big break for Texas Tech. One was the fumble recovery inside the five, and now this. And Brooks, again, only about a yard. That's it.
Yeah, you can see him sneaking down to the box, and he goes up to block it and just redirects his hands. That's about as impressive an interception as I've seen at the line of scrimmage. That is so tough to do.
By the way, Tech's got 9 interceptions this year. Baskerville's got 3 of them now in the aftermath of that one. Got an injured Red Raider down on the field. Looked like Davion Carter, the right guard, number 56, and they are assisting him to the sideline. Baskerville, as we mentioned, has 3 of the 9, so he's made a habit of this.
Oh, of course. He's got great range, and his skills are on full display in this pack. Watch him run outside the hash and go make this play diving, and then against Arizona, watch him right in the middle of the field, and then he just starts to sprint and covers 15 yards to make a play and get the foot down. He's got hands like a wide receiver, and then you just saw the most recent interception. So impressive. Like I talked about earlier, he's played really well in the pass game, and today he's played well in the run game as well.
That's the young man that Josh Sims told us had that private meeting with his coaching staff, and he really implored Joey McGuire.
Well, start. Offense number 79, 5-yard penalty, second down.
As though that'll back him up, as Sterling Porche, the left guard, was tagged with that penalty. But he Baskerville implored him, said, let Coach DeRuiter call his plays.
He did.
Turn us loose.
And not like Coach McGuire wasn't going to allow it, right? But, you know, Baskerville's been through this. He's seen, okay, things aren't going well. Maybe we start to be a little vanilla, and that's not conducive to the success of their defense. And so he just wanted Coach DeRuiter to have the free reins, handcuffs off, to make plays.
Down the seam, that one goes off the helmet of the defender as they were shooting that ball downfield for Savion Williams. Jamel Johnson, I beg your pardon. That was Josh Kelly that was the intended receiver.
That's the way to use your head.
Yeah. And it was Jamel's head, number 2, that got in the way of it.
I mean, I know he wasn't looking, but that's a PBU. That's a PBU for
it
Johnson.
Sure is. Well, Scott Alexander's all over that.
Coaches always say use your head, and I don't know if they meant that way, but yeah, they'll take it.
Well, Josh Kelly was open, number 3 in white, but number 2's noggin got in the way. Douglas. Boy, he is hammered. Look at those guys in purple all arriving in a bad humor. This TCUD has really answered the bell and have taken last week's momentum against a porous Utah offense with quarterback problems.
Yeah,
take a look. Well, today,
take a look here at Bud Clark come down and make this play. Now, he doesn't get him down initially. However, he stops the play from happening and the rest of his teammates can come and race to the tackle. Bud Clark was, first of all, one of the coolest interviews we've had talking to a player. And he said, I'm not a big guy, but I'm going to go and shoot my shot. And that's exactly what he did right there. And he said his mom told him, hey, give it everything you got, and the rest of your teammates will help. Perfectly displayed right there.
Burkhart from 50 yards. He's got the big leg, but this time it's wide and no good. So Burkhart, who takes the long kicks and handles the kickoff chores, had enough leg, but pushed it to the right. So that's the first miss of the season for Texas Tech, and it comes from Reese Burkhart from distance. They were 11 of 11 in field goal tries as a team, but all of them belonged to Garcia. But a great opportunity for Burkhart.
Hey, I don't know who's doing the music in the stadium, but the song comes on, to the right, to the right, to the right, to the left. What a great job by the DJ to make sure that everybody knows what happened on the field goal.
They do it first class here at TCU.
Do you know how to do that dance? It's a
hustle.
Do your dance, do your dance.
Absolutely, I've done that.
Yeah, right, come on.
Yeah, but I sometimes wiggle my derriere to go along with take the step. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I know.
Just can't help myself. Here's Savion out of the Wildcat again. and nothing doing. I don't know that he made it back to the line of scrimmage.
Okay, for the one thing about Savion Williams and the Wildcat, it looks like Texas Tech has kind of found out, okay, he's not going to throw the ball on the year. He's 100% keep. Right, 100% keep when he's in the Wildcat. Now, he played quarterback in high school. I would love to see a different variation where he throws the ball just to keep this defense honest when he gets the ball in that situation. But at running back, they cannot play dishonest.
Second and 10. On the check down, it's Savion. Yards after catch. Boy, oh boy. I mean, most mortals would have been stopped at the line of scrimmage. He got about five out of that. Couple of missed tackles forced by number three.
I mean, that's one missed tackle, right? He's in the air when he starts to get attacked and somehow still makes a miss. That's two missed tackles. And then that's three, and he just continues to power his way down the field, electric with the football in his hands.
Third down and six. They'll give him four. Oh, now they've changed it. Third down and five.
Got single high man-to-man down at the bottom of your screen. There it goes.
Yep, and the little look-in pattern goes incomplete. Blake Nowell, 87, had it, but could not control it as he went to the ground. TCU will be forced to punt it away.
And those are the plays that you just have to make. You get what you want, right? You get single high, man-to-man coverage. You get open. The ball's thrown perfectly. You have got to make that play because it's going to continue this drive. But you don't, and you punt the ball away back to Texas Tech.
Ethan Cross boot high sky in the air, and it's taken down by Brown with another fair catch. Been a busy day. Big noon was a little tighter than the folks in Columbus expected. Mike Hill's going to tell us what's coming up on the State Farm halftime show.
It's Halloween, yeah. You know.
He's going to give it the. He's going to go that route. Three and change remaining in this half. Not much for Brooks all day. They're going to continue to feed and fan him, though. And trust me, you may stop him for a long time, but at some point he can pop one. And when he does, you'll know about it.
Yeah, he wears on defenses, right? He's the kind of running back that gets stronger and stronger as the game goes on. So that's something to monitor. Even though TCU's defense has really held him in check, that may not last forever.
They go empty here, second and eight for Baron Martin. Little curl, and it is brought in by Josh Kelly. They'll give him the 32-yard line.
I really like how offensive coordinator Zach Kittley is really helping Baron Martin and giving him answers before the play. And what I mean by that is taking Taj Brooks and putting him outside at wide receiver. You see, who goes with him? Does a cornerback stay out there, or do you take a linebacker out there? Obi Izor goes out there, and so now the quarterback has an answer. Baron Martin knows it's man-to-man coverage and he can get to his best man-to-man route.
Tech is only 2 out of 8 on third down, so we've got a marker down at the point of attack. Kelly may have moved too quickly up there.
Both tackles, I think, kind of went a little early. I don't know which one they're going to give it to, but it looked like they both – everybody except the center, actually.
Full start. Offense number 75, 5-yard penalty. Third down.
That really sucks.
Yeah.
Because everybody moved, but they picked 75 and gives it to him.
Poor time, right? Buchanan. It could have been on Josh Kelly. It could have been.
Yep, it's everybody here in the middle moving except for the center, and 75 gets credit with the penalty. At home, we're sorry to the parents. That's fun, very unfortunate for Ty Buchanan.
Third down at 8. Just 15 yards penalty-wise against Tech. Morton floats one up. It is caught near midfield. Beautiful catch by number 10. Yeah, that's got that number 12, Jalen Conyers, the tight end.
Yeah, Jalen Conyers is a guy that's really good at man-to-man opportunities, and they get into man-to-man there, and he wins on the perfect man-to-man beater, a corner route.
And that year, and frankly, either he or Baylor should have played for the national championship. In the first year of that, we know what happened to the Big 12, but they were incredible football teams that were left at the altar, and in today's college football would have been a part of the postseason. Well, that one's thrown away.
That's a really nice job by defensive coordinator Andy Avalos of showing one picture and then getting to a different picture for Baron Morton. He shows man-to-man, single high, and then he bursts into a cover two shell, and now Baron Morton has nowhere to go with the ball. He tries to extend the play, and it's a wasted down. A very nice job by that TCU defense and Andy Avalos.
Pass was intended for Brooks. Again, they go twin tight ends. Second and 10. Brooks, look at that. Sidesteps one, runs through another. Finally, it's Devin Deal, number 11, that will get credited with the stop. That's his longest rush for the afternoon.
We said it, didn't we? Starts to wear on you. Can't keep him in check forever.
Now Morton pulls it down. I think that was a busted play from the jump, and he decided, you know what, I'm going to tuck it and try to get back to the line of scrimmage, and he managed the yard.
Well, it's busted because TCU recognizes it right away, right? They try to go to the fake screen and then sneak the blocker down the field. They cover it, and that's a nice job by Baron Morton, not making a bad play worse. Pull it down and try to go get a few yards. He gets one. TCU right now is lining up in a middle open defense, right? So you can get guys to the middle, but Andy Avalos has done a nice job of changing the picture at the snap.
Hodge is coming on a blitz up the gut. They throw deep, and it's incomplete. Tremendous coverage again. Caleb Douglas, the intended receiver. Javon McIver with the play.
I think you're right. Really good coverage, but an even better throw. Baron Morton drops that ball in the bucket yet again. That coverage is as good as it gets. And he's, you know, a little handsy there.
Yep.
However, he drops that ball outside shoulder exactly where you want it, but Douglas can't quite get to it.
Well, let's say it was handsy. I think he had him by the face mask.
Yeah, you know, a little handsy.
Yeah.
I mean, playing defensive back is a really difficult
task.
It
is. And they allow a lot more jousting in this sport than they do the one on Sundays.
They deserve a little bit of grace, if you will.
Third and 9. And a quick flag. It's going to be procedure, false start after they showed blitz TCU. And Stephen Barron is waiting on the information from his linesman. It'll be their third false start.
I didn't see anybody move, though.
Mm-hmm. Looks like we're having a conversation, which at times means they'll pick it up.
Yeah, I did not see movement from the offensive lineman. And so it was a receiver on the outside, maybe, but they're having such a long conversation for it.
Prior to the false start, we had a timeout by TCU, their second charge timeout of the half. 30-second timeout.
There's a break for the Red Raiders. Timeout was taken, and Sonny Dykes is like, wait a minute. Bottom line, the matchups are better, the games mean more, and with 12 teams in the playoff, we're going to have one whale of a November to remember.
Yeah.
Morton in a world of hurt, and down he goes. First sack of the afternoon for the Horned Frogs. And it's pulled off by Kamara. Abe Kamara, that nickelbacker, coming through yet again.
Yeah, I mean, he's done such a nice job. Here he is coming off the edge here. He's a safety, but his blitzing ability has been really, really nice. He takes on a tackle, right? He hits the tackle right in his chest, bounces off, and goes to help make the play. Outstanding job by that defensive back.
You know, we thought coming in that we would have an offensive showcase today, but Texas Tech has 3 sacks, okay, and 5 tackles for losses. The first TCU sack of the game. These defensive teams have played well, and yet we've had 31 points scored.
Yeah, I know, right? It's kind of a weird deal. We're watching this game, and the defenses are playing well, but there's points on the board. And it started with the talented wide receiver turned running back. And, again, that Baskerville interception is one of the nicest you'll see all weekend.
That was a big stop for TCU psychologically.
Yeah.
Because they had control of the first quarter. The interception bug, which has really been a problem for them, has reared its ugly head. But if they had been behind by 2 scores after the way they had played, for the most part, on both sides of the ball, that would have been, for them, a mental dungeon they might have been in. So a big stop for them.
A mental dungeon. I like that.
Something that happens to most golfers after a 45 or bigger score on the front nine.
I heard you're always in a mental dungeon on that course. Huh?
Well, We've had some very important scores in college football so far today. Notre Dame takes care of one undefeated. These games played on Thursday and Friday, and Indiana gets it done against UW at home today and without their quarterback.
Man, in a big way.
Yeah, in a big way. That's huge for them and their confidence. Ole Miss staves off a struggling Oklahoma team at Vaught-Hemingway. And how about the Pitt Panthers? Beano Cook is up in heaven smiling from ear to ear. His beloved Panthers move to 8-0 under Coach Narduzzi. Quick out pattern. Look out for Besh. He wisely steps out before preparing to absorb a hit. And the veteran from LSU that transferred over steps out.
With just 32 seconds and no timeouts, if the ball's thrown into the middle of the field, if you have any hopes of getting points, you have to make sure that it is a first down, and then you have to hurry the ball, or the ball has to be thrown to the sideline to make sure you stop the clock and going out of bounds.
Second and three. Hoover's pass towards Besh. Had to get rid of it again, though, for pressure coming off the blind side, and it's third down and three. They've had a rough go these last five drives.
Yeah.
From an offensive standpoint, after really scintillating in the first quarter.
For Hoover, you have to remember, hunting is not a bad thing. You don't have to go get points here. It will be nice, but do not make the situation bad by turning the ball over, trying to play superhero, and make a play that isn't there. But they've got single high with a one-on-one down here at the bottom of the screen with the best player on the football field.
Third down and three. Marker down. And there's the slant pattern that is taken in for the first down, which will stop the clock at the 32 for Savion Williams, who owned the first quarter of this game with a couple of touchdowns, one on the ground, one in the air. And we await the marker. Texas Tech has controlled the second quarter and got it started with a turnover. And Joey McGuire's really got to be pumped about the way his team responded after falling behind 14-3. And we got another one of these long conversations taking place.
Don't like them. Don't like the long conversations, personally.
Too much democracy.
Yeah. Illegal shift, offense, two players in motion at the same time and did not set. 5-yard penalty, third down.
Just continuously shooting yourself in the foot.
Yep.
Pick up a first down, you get the ball to the, like I said, best player on the football field at the time. He gets a first down and it's taken away because of a procedural penalty. And it seems like right now TCU can't get out of their own way, especially after that first quarter.
Remember, Texas Tech will get the ball to open the second half. And they have dominated the second quarter and imposed their will on the defensive end. They're just going to let the clock run out now. I think that's a wise choice on their part. Things have not been going well. Let's see if the biorhythms can pick up at the intermission. It's been entertaining, though, partner. It has been.
Yes, it has.
Tech is 4-0 this year when leading at the half, 16-2 under McGuire. Now let's send you to the studio in Los Angeles. Mike Hill, Emmanuel Acho, and Coach Pete. From the state. You got to practice it all week. Texas Tech will get it to open the second half, and they'll bring it out. Here comes the return out to the 23-yard line, and let's go down to Josh Sims.
Well, Timmy B, Joey McGuire, happy with the way his team responded after falling behind 14-0. He said it's not just about forcing those turnovers, but also putting points on the board when they got those turnovers. He said, last week's special teams killed us, but how about that fake field goal? And I asked him about that. A smile came across his face. He said, hey, we've been waiting to use that for a while. We got to keep it up here in the second half, though.
Indeed. Well, it... along with the sack fumble, those two big plays turned the fortunes of this game around and enabled Texas Tech to have the lead. And generally speaking, when they're in there leading the game at halftime, they're in great shape. And they begin with a new quarterback in the game. Morton was hurt, apparently, was injured at halftime. A left shoulder injury. We were just told that. And Will Hammond is in at quarterback for Texas Tech.
Well, that's no good for Texas Tech, because not just because it's their starting quarterback, but obviously not a bunch of reps for Will Hammond, a true freshman. And
the quarterback, Baron Morton, was just playing well.
Yep. So they get it out to Josh Kelly. He's going to need a lot of help from his friends out of Austin, Texas. Hutto High. And
he's got his towel over his head, shoulder pads off, and that's news. Never a good sign.
No, bad news indeed. Shoulder injury to him, and Hammond gets the call.
Yeah, Will Hammond on the season, 5-of-7, 71%, 70 yards, and he's rushed two times for 11 yards. So, like I said, not a bunch of experience. However, it's his team right now until further notice.
Hutto High School, Austin, Texas. Third down and three. You know they got to ride Brooks, right? They got to fake it to him, and he's going to carry it. And he does so for the first down. That's got to be a confidence boost for the young man out to the 41.
Yeah, he rushed for 11 yards on the season, and then he gets almost about 11 there. I mean, what a nice run pulling that ball out and playing on the TCU defense, not knowing his skill set.
Was a prolific high schooler, as you might imagine. You don't get to this level as a true freshman without having been one. Again, he'll lean on Brooks this half, no doubt about it. There's a nice looking pattern, and how about that maneuver by Caleb Douglas?
Nice run by the quarterback. Nice run by Taj Brooks. Now you can get to what we love, the RPO. Safeties come down, and you got a ball, even though behind, a catchable ball for Caleb Douglas, and then an outstanding move to get the ball down the field. They talked about Caleb Douglas and his improvement and how he's really gotten his feet under him in this offense, and it's very, very clear. And his skill set is on full display today.
36 yards. I think he got some turf in his eye, and he had to take himself out of the game. But he beat Travis Broughton on that play. The yards after the catch. So first and 10, and now they go with a fade pattern into the corner. It's caught. It's touchdown. Coy Aiken. Wow. Just like that. And I would say this prolific high schooler has announced to his team and everyone else.
I mean, he's a guy who's passed for 8,000 plus yards in high school. And what a perfect throw, cold off the bench.
Oh, man.
And the footwork by Aiken. Touchdown, Texas Tech.
8,700 yards to be exact in his days in high school. And he proved to us on that drive that he could run the football well,
no
too.
No reps, no problem.
That's amazing.
What do I need reps for? Right? Just throw me in there. I'll throw a nice RPO slant. I'll pull the ball out. I'll run.
The play is a touchdown. After the play, personal foul. Roughing the passer, defense. That 15-yard penalty will be enforced on the succeeding spot. Try.
And Tim, not only do I pull bottom run, not only do I throw a dart for it on RPO, but I also throw a perfect fade and take a hit in the face with a penalty. How about that for the young fella?
No doubt. And a double whammy, too, with the personal foul penalty, because now they'll have 15 yards on the kickoff. They could squib it. They could onside it. They could do a lot of different things.
For TCU, just when you think, you know, their quarterback's out, we're probably going to take control of this game back. I mean, this young kid just drives right down the field seamlessly.
MVP of his district. And you think about the school district. It's one of the most powerful. It's 12-6. And his senior year, he was the 13th ranked quarterback by Rivals. I'd say he's a little better than 13th now. Aiken's got him. And that young man.
I mean, that's a long handoff, though.
What
I love Aiken, and it's a great catch, but we got to give a credit to the young guy.
Ooh,
that is
man.
A long handoff. He essentially, the only thing he could do better is just walk it right to him and put it in his hands.
His high school, he was a District 12 6A top quarterback. And man, oh man, he looked like a top quarterback on that drive. Talk about being thrown into it. And they do squib it, as I suspected. And it's taken at the 25-yard line. Let's go to Josh Sims.
Well, Sonny Dykes told me at halftime that, look, we got off to a good start, but it's been the story all season long, turnovers. He said these turnovers are killing us. It's hard to get anything going if we don't take care of the football. That was the message to the team in the second half. They need to protect the ball if they want any shot of coming away with a win here.
Tim, what were the keys? At least break even. And right now they're not even, and they're losing the turnover battle yet again. I mean, it's really repetitive for coaches and the fans to see the offense continue to turn the ball over.
Hoover stepping up in the pocket, now decides to tuck it and run. Sonny said he wanted to see more of that. He did tote it one time in the first half, very successfully, and he gets out ahead for four there.
I mean, how about Tim DeRuiter and this defense responding from a week ago?
Oh, man.
They're, today, three sacks, five tackles for loss, one forced fumble. I mean, it's been a huge difference for this Texas Tech defense.
And Hoover's hurting after getting up from that run he had a moment ago. Savion Williams twirled out of bounds at the 31. He seemed to be favoring his right arm, or maybe his lower, maybe the groin area. It was actually holding in the extremities after he fell down and got up from this tackle just moments ago.
Just a hand to the middle of his body.
Sure was.
And it's always the aftermath, right? You feel it
sure
a little later.
Mm-hmm. You see that left arm going there.
Doesn't feel good.
Third down and five. Let's see if he can stay in there. Jeremy Payne is checked back in, the freshman from Missouri City. He had a great drive that ended on downs when they were stopped, and he's going to try to loop one to him now. And it's another tip, and it's another interception. Boy, it's like a recurring nightmare for Hoover and Sonny Dykes. At midfield, ball was tipped by Dyson, Harvey Dyson, 33, intercepted by Chapman Lewis, 25.
Yeah, and Harvey Dyson's not going to get a stat on this, but how about him just fighting, and then number 25, Lewis, flying over the top, just making his way toward the play. And when you race to the football, good things happen. A good thing happened there for the defense. That's two interceptions on the day, three turnovers for TCU's offense.
And the 10th Texas Tech interception this season. And that's one thing DeRuiter was counting on in this game. He said, you know, Hoover's good when he's left alone.
Yeah.
You've got to put pressure on him. We plan on doing that, and it's paid some dividends, particularly lately. And it shouldn't surprise you that they're going to try to pound the rock much of this game the rest of the way, as Brooks has stopped again at the point of attack.
You know, I wouldn't do that. I wouldn't change what you've done. And I would call this game as if you're even, or maybe if you're losing the game, because Hammond is shown to be trusted on that last drive. And use the run game, use the pass game the way you would if this game was dead even. And Dyson, number 33 on defense, has really been impressive. Obviously, he's got the sack fumble and then that tip to cause an interception.
Second and 10. Oh, that's a quick put that foot in the ground and then plant it and make your move. Nice little run by Dominic Johnson. That's a five-yard pickup, or excuse me, Jacoby Williams, 20.
Yeah, he's a true freshman, a guy who doesn't get a bunch of reps because obviously you have number 28, Taj Brooks, who is going to essentially lead the Texas Tech Red Raiders history as the leading rusher. But that young fella, Jacoby Williams, you can see the kind of burst that he has, sticking his foot in the ground and making plays. And this is not a down where you have to throw the football. They can still run the football on this down.
Freshman to freshman, youngster out of Beckville, Texas, Jacoby Williams. That's a little curl, complete, out to the line to make. So move the chains yet again inside the 40 to the 39. Caleb Douglas with a six-yard reception. They're in rhythm. I mean, it's as if, you know, it's as if Will Hammond's been around forever. Now he's got no place to go, and he gets as much out of it as he can. Maybe the line of scrimmage or a yard, and that's all.
Yeah, and you're exactly right when you say that. They haven't missed a beat, and dare I say, they're a little more efficient with him right now. It's really impressive to watch because, like I said, a true freshman, a guy who doesn't have a bunch of reps on the season, he's only thrown seven passes, and to come out and have such efficiency, it's really impressive.
Zach Kittley's got to be beaming right now with the way this young man's playing. On second and nine, quick pitch, it's Williams again. And he's the perfect complement when you think about it. Oh, and look at him get up and show you. First down, let's keep on moving.
Wait a minute, Tim. That is a different kind of burst.
Yep.
Did you see when he touched that football, the acceleration right away? I mean, unbelievable. Watch him get through the defense.
And they're going to once again come back, check it down, and get it to his favorite target, Caleb Douglas. Whether it's a short pattern or a streak down the sidelines, which he made a big 45-yarder earlier. He's been the go-to guy for both quarterbacks. Taj Brooks back out there.
That acceleration by young Williams is really impressive. And think about this, Tim, for Texas Tech fans. That's a true freshman quarterback and a true freshman running back working together on this drive, but they bring Todd Brooks back into the game.
Out of the shotgun, Brooks. A big jump cut, and he's in for another first down inside the 15 to the 13-yard line. I think that's the move, the fundamental move he has, Devin, that I enjoy most watching. The little jump cut, part of the patience that he shows, he'll utilize fundamental.
He gets into the line of scrimmage, right, and then he kind of gets skinny, right? Gets skinny and jump cuts, not necessarily always sideways, but he goes at kind of a 45-degree angle to get through the hole. And the one thing that's super impressive is he's always falling forward.
Cameron Dickey has come into the game for Texas Tech. Now they run a little chicanery. Looking to throw it here is Aiken, a former quarterback himself. And TCU had the scouting report on that one, and he had to just throw it away.
Yeah, they were all over it for sure. And a nice decision by Aiken, making sure that he throws that football away. The deep safeties have to stay deep and make sure they start to come up, but then they retreat, and cover everything. Nice job by Aiken, though, to save yardage and throw that football away. You can see the old quarterback in him, huh?
No, no doubt about it. Absolutely. You know, and it seems as though in this league, in the Big 12, just about every receiver, every team has a receiver, maybe two, that are former quarterbacks in high school. Second down and 10. Look at that youthful look, huh? Quick curl. It's caught. There's Kelly, and Josh Kelly scampers inside the 5-yard line, very close to the line to make. About a yard away, it would appear.
Remember the last time we had Texas Tech? Kelly was a huge part of this offense. We haven't really seen him do a bunch today, only four catches on the day. And he's kind of been resorted to kind of a possession guy because of number five, Caleb Douglas, who's really turned into that big play threat down the field.
Third down and a long one. TCU on its heels, desperately need a stop.
You got one-on-one at the bottom of your screen here.
And he keeps it. It's a touchdown. How about this? The freshman. And I do mean freshman. Not many reps before having to come in to open this second half. Two brilliant drives. Hammond had 37 rushing yards. Now getting it done with a touchdown to go with it.
Yeah, watch him pull this ball and then get there and then underneath for a touchdown. I mean, so impressive what he's been able to do coming into this game. Again, with limited reps, cold, he's looked phenomenal.
37 yards rushing in high school, and a couple of scampers he's made in this game to show you what he's made of. That's absolutely amazing.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, do it again indeed. And again and again.
And maybe one more time.
And TCU's season is on the line when we come. And we've seen every aspect of his positives in two drives.
Oh, yeah. Yes, we have. I mean, I guess I got to say it again, right? It's such a surprise. We didn't expect to see this kid. Yeah. I'm sure TCU didn't expect for him to play the way he's playing just coming in cold. So,
Caleb Douglas. You know, Hammond, we talked about what a tremendous dual threat he was at the high school level. And you just saw the whole package on those two drives. 84 yards passing, 37 rushing touchdowns while he was in high school, 121 total, picking up right where he left off at this level.
It's a Jersey Mike's thing, a sub above.
Aflac trivia question is sponsored by Aflac. Get help with expenses health insurance doesn't cover with Aflac. Who was the last Texas Tech head coach to beat TCU in back-to-back years?
That's a good one.
That's
a good one.
Having a Vern Lundquist moment thinking about the Aflac question. they used to have that when I was at another network you may have heard of. He was working the play-by-play, and I was doing my impression of Rob Stone or Mike Hill in a studio. That's Trent Battle carrying it ahead for a couple of yards, and
hey,
that's
Tim,
about it.
I'm just telling you, I think that the answer, the last name rhymes with Yikes.
Oh, you're going to go Spike Dykes on me? Is that what you're saying?
I think you might.
You're thinking Spike Dykes. Well, maybe. He's certainly would be a strong candidate. Oh, that pass was almost juggled and right into the arms of a defender that could have gone for a potential pick six.
And, yeah, he got it right.
There
it
we go.
Was Spike Dykes.
We saw him earlier.
The legendary Spike Dykes.
That's right. I was thinking Mike Leach, but then I'm like, I don't know.
Right. You got to remember, TCU was good in those years, too, when Mike was there. What a guy he was to work with. I loved Spike. He was just one of the most charismatic coaches of his generation. Third down, Hoover needs to do something, and they're going to get a flag. That's the end result of some holding on Savion Williams that was taking place.
Yeah, Brendan Jordan, I think he grabbed his face mask and snatched it to the ground.
He did.
I love when a guy clearly pulls him, and then he likes thinking, like, what did I do?
They're talking about it, too. Savion's jawing with him as we speak.
Personal foul. Face mask, defense number 7, 15-yard penalty, automatic first down.
You think about it, sometimes it's good to go ahead and commit the foul rather than have Savion make a big play on you.
Honestly, right? Because he's going to be open. He did a nice job of setting him up into the inside to go back out, and he just had to pull him. You know, didn't necessarily have to pull his face mask, but he does, and it's a 15-yard.
Remember, Savion has 128 yards and 2 touchdowns on only 9 touches, so probably a good penalty to pick up.
Yeah.
Blitz coming. Hoover lets it fly for Besh. What a catch, but did he? Yeah, he ran out of real estate.
Yeah, it's right
Man,
foot.
That was a wonderful catch, but he was led just a bit too far by
He's
Hoover.
Still down.
And Stevenson was in coverage with him, and Jack Besh is still on the ground.
Yeah, I mean, great over-the-shoulder catch. That right foot just steps on the out-of-bounds line. So, but when you fall so hard, right, because he's trying to keep his feet in, that's tough.
Let's hope that he just knocked the air out from under him, and he's struggling with that, and it's nothing else that could be more serious. That young man is a breath of fresh air and deserves to stay healthy the rest of the year. One of the real leaders of this TCU offense, Jack Besh. Right up the middle, and look out, Cam Cook. 5'11", sophomore from Round Rock, Texas. He hit the hole with authority for 19.
Yeah, and because of motion, right, you bring motion around, and it leaves a vacancy. All the defenders move to their left, and he has a small hole to get through, and he starts to cook right through it.
He sure did. Hoover, backside pressure. Has to unload and does, and it's caught by the tight end, Dabney. He's got it to the 25, or they'll mark him at the 27, a gain of 12. Baskerville on top of it.
Turnovers have been a problem this season, but when Hoover's good, this is what you get. The ability to move inside the pocket, keep his base, and the ability to make a throw down the field off platform. Outstanding job by him to pick up that first down.
He's awfully accurate. One more time to Dabney, who is hammered at the 21 by Cromwell. They're happy to have Devin Cromwell good to go. Another one of those outstanding guys at the second level.
And that's good recognition there by the quarterback Hoover. He sees blitz off the edge, and what you usually want to do as a quarterback, attack the blitz. He attacks the blitz. He has an open guy, and it sets up a second and short. And down on the field is the person that made the tackle,
right.
Cromwell.
Yeah, his head hit the wrong way, and so did his arm. This poor young man's been banged up. They were really happy to have him back. And they are moving the football. Jeremy Payne's coming to the game. And this is Savion on a quick pitch towards the boundary. He tries to cut it back up. And is going to be given, I think, a couple of yards, maybe a yard or so shy of the first down. So third and one after a gain of 3.
And another thing to remember, Tim, this is their first trip into the red zone.
That's right.
Those other touchdowns were long touchdowns from outside the red zone. So
35 and 75 from Savion.
Yep.
And Ben Roberts, 13, the middle linebacker, came in to make that play to stop him a yard shy of the first down. Let's see what they do here. Here's an interesting formation.
They've got a real opportunity one-on-one with McAllister against the smaller Lux.
They chuck it down to JP. There's Patterson with a great move. Oh, he's making Bucky proud. And headed right towards where Bucky and his family sits. He gets it down inside the 2. Ben Roberts, 13, with a stop. 17 big yards.
I mean, 1-2, 1-2, whoop! There, over there. I mean, such an outstanding runner after the catch.
Payne is in the backfield.
And he's got it. Touchdown, Jeremy Payne. That last lunge got him in there. His second this season. And now TCU's back in the game. They desperately needed a touchdown on this drive.
Yeah, they did. And you're right about that second lunge because he stopped, right? They've got him stopped. And then he reaches and sails out to put the ball over the goal line. Touchdown, TCU. I'm sure they're going to take a look and see if that thigh and knee stayed above the ground before the ball broke the plane.
Wouldn't be
it
shocked.
It looks good to me.
Yeah.
But, you know, you got to look at it from every angle.
Put Pereira on alert.
Yep. Come on, Mike. Make an appearance.
The ruling on the field of a touchdown is under further review.
All right, so everything's up right there. Nope, he's down. He's down before it gets to the goal line.
Yeah.
But the one thing that you have to remember, if there's not a straight down the line shot, I don't think they can reverse this, but they will be able to piece different film together. Yeah, it looks like he's clearly short. He's clearly short. The ball's going to be about the half-yard line by my estimation. Hey, Mike, what do you think? I think they got him at the half-yard line. What do you got for us?
I see no reason to go against you. See, no reason at all. I mean, I was looking for the shot, too, to try to prove that the knee was down. And, again, as you said, piecing him together, you know, to me, you can see that the knee is down before the big stretch. And I think he's short, which is why I'm going with you all the way.
By the way, Mike Pereira, that is as congenial a response to an analyst as I think I've ever heard. And you had a few of them last night with Brock Heward and Jason Benetti into the wee hours in the Eastern and Central time zone.
Yeah.
He had to stay close to home at our studios to come into work today.
You know, it's really impressive that, you know, he still looks so good because I'm sure he hasn't slept, right? He hasn't slept. He's been working all day, all night. And so, Mike, you look good, and I always love when you agree with me.
Well, the big misnomer to me is big noon kickoff. It's not big noon out here in Los Angeles. It's big 9 a.m.
It's big 9 a.m. for you.
Yeah, after a midnight soiree here at the studios, it was back here very early.
Oh, man.
After further review, the ruling on the field of a touchdown stands.
Wow.
Well,
so,
he didn't
agree like
with
I
us.
Said, that not ability to have the right down the line shot, right, Mike? Is that's why they kept it as it was called on the field.
Probably.
That's it, but I bet my bottom dollar it was short. But it's
I think it was clearly short, but, you know, without the direct down the line, it has to be indisputable, right, Mike?
The replay official sending a message.
Get
the pylon camera, boys. You better have it. I'm with you. I totally agree.
Well, that's good, though, for TCU.
It is. That saves, in a lot of ways, the game circumstances and finally ends 28 unanswered points by Texas Tech. The home team is satisfied.
I mean, that has to feel good to put a drive together when you've had, right, you own the first quarter, right? It was very clear. It was all TCU. And then it just slowly slipped away from you, and Texas Tech started to find success, and then they bring in a new quarterback, and he has even more success. So it was tough for, I'm sure, Horned Frog fans to watch, but that was encouraging to see them drive down the field so seamlessly.
Josh Sims, I'm curious because we think we know where Baron Morton got hurt in the first half. Can you tell us a little more?
Yeah, it appears that Baron Morton got hurt late in the first half, injured that shoulder. That's all I was really told about the injury, but I could tell you the frustration I saw from him walking off the field, screaming just in anger at the injury. Obviously, the team doing well without him right now. He's on the sideline. Of course, he wants to support his guys out there, but he will not return to the game. I can also tell you that Taj Brooks, who went to the locker room, is back out on the sideline and expected to return.
Yeah, that's the bigger news, clearly, for Texas Tech, is they certainly don't want to lose Taj Brooks.
Yeah, and that play is where we think it kind of happened, where he reaches that left arm out to brace himself, and the shoulder's probably jammed into his shoulder pads, and you see him on the sideline with his sling. And the one thing I will tell you, this guy's made of the right stuff, right? So he is going to be the biggest fan and supporter of his backup, Will Hammond.
Here comes Ja'Cory Williams. He's quick, has a hiccup. He's trying to get away from that scrum, but can't in the fantastic college football season.
You can
the
see
World, yeah, World
Brooks
Series
is
underway.
Back out there as well.
Yep, Brooks is
but he's
good
not
news.
On the field.
No, he's not
it's
on the
Ja'Cory
field.
It's Ja'Cory Williams, the spark plug.
with great burst.
From the 21, Hammond, who's been incredible since coming into the game. Hands it off this time to Williams. They might give him a yard, and that's it. Second and nine. This young man, his best game came against North Texas with four carries for 27 yards. Out of Beckville, Texas, as we mentioned, very highly thought of, and you can see why. And when you're spelling a guy like Taj Brooks with a completely different style of runner, it can be the perfect complement to an offense. That quickness right there. I mean, he gets to the second level in a heartbeat.
And Tim, I'm just telling you, he comes from good stock. His father, Charles, football at Texas Southern, and his grandfather was an All-American center at Prairie View. So, I mean, he's not a guy who doesn't know football and understand what it takes to be good at this level.
Third down and four. A long four here for Hammond.
A guy that's not on the field right now, Abe Kamara, a guy who's made a bunch of plays on the edge and in the back end. He's not on the field right now.
Williams. Boy, he's got it. That's a first down. Beyond the 31-yard line, and that was the line to make. Obi Izor will get credit for the tackle, but that keeps the clock running towards the end of this, the third quarter. Texas Tech with a two-score lead of 10. Williams tried to bounce it back inside and is rustled to the ground by Cam Smith. That initial hit, though, was applied up front, and he tried to spin out of it.
And I think it's just a natural rotation for Abe Kamara and Cam Smith. Cam Smith, number 29, is in the game for Kamara. But for me, I really love to see Kamara in the game. He's made too many plays, and it's crunch time, right? It's winning time. You need to get a stop here. We're down two scores.
Second down and seven. Quick out. Beautiful control, and they get the guy that has been devastating on this TCU secondary, Caleb Douglas. Boy, does he run outstanding routes.
I mean, one-on-one coverage, and he runs just a nice button hook like they called it in your day, Tim.
Mm-hmm.
Snaps down, gets back to the quarterback, and he's wide open for a first down.
I don't know how many times in a front yard game of tackle football, and we did play tackle in those days, you go down here, you button hook to the left.
That's right.
Yep. I mean, we could be watching a Wally Pipp moment in college football the way Hammond is playing. I mean, he's got great composure. We think the world of Baron Morton, but this is incredible stuff we're witnessing right now.
And at the least, at the very least, you have a really good backup, right?
No doubt.
A guy where now you're not as worried when Baron Morton gets hurt because he has had injury history. You understand that number 15 in white is a guy that can come in and win you football games, and he's putting it on display right now.
Some might wonder about Cameron Brown, the sophomore from Byron, Georgia, who is listed on the two deep as their second. Well, he's inside and out, and we're happy to have you with us. Fox coverage of Big 12 football, game number two of the college game with the World Series yet to come. And there's Taj Brooks. Boy, oh boy, right when you need it. On the ground, they are chewing up yardage now in chunks, whether it's he or Jacoby Williams.
Yeah, they're not quite into that four-minute offense situation just yet, but what a weapon to have in Taj Brooks if you want to kind of salt clock away with this two-score lead.
And you think, well, he may not get 100 today because they've keyed on him. They've kept him from having the big plays. But as time goes on and this defense gets a little fatigued, look out, because he can pop one and put the game away just like that. And Hammond has been right on target with his arm with every pass he's thrown. Looks like we got a marker down. Looks like we may have another delay of game this time.
Delay of game.
Yep.
Offense, 5-yard penalty, first down.
Well, right as I gave him a compliment,
well,
that's
finally
the first mistake.
Finally, he looks like a freshman. My goodness.
It's about time this young man had a faux pas.
Yeah.
Joey McGuire not only had and Zach Kittley, they had more than just a few tricks up their sleeve and in their hip pockets today. Really started with that fake field goal when you think about it. Brooks, boy, he's not that far away from popping it.
Yeah, and when you look at his running style, a lot of people would remind you of a Le'Veon Bell. Remember, he used to get the ball and kind of sit at the line of scrimmage. But the one thing that him and Le'Veon Bell, they both have, is the ability to hit the hole like the old school, like you really want them to. They don't always dance. They just dance when they have to.
Oh, nice look throw. At that pass. Oh. I mean, a laser throw. Caught and taken down inside the 15-yard line, and it's Coy Aiken again.
I mean, so precise. You've run the ball well, sticking in there, and then right on his numbers where he can catch and run. I'm just telling you, ball placement is so important because instead of a catch and fall or a catch and tackle, it's catch and get a lot more yardage. Like we talked about, Hammond has been special in this game.
And Aiken, I believe, on that tackle, which was a shoestring variety, might have gotten a high ankle sprain. As you can see, he got rolled on a little bit there by Broughton, who was making the tackle. And he was starting to get up and then had to fall to the ground. Looks like he's going to be okay, though. He's gingerly making his way back under his own power. And that's good news because he has been a steadying influence at wide receiver. Kelly has had his moments as well. Caleb Douglas has been the multitasking receiver all day long. But Andy Avalos is having some difficulty dealing with this new quarterback. And you had precious little scouting on him coming into today's game. I mean, that's really a blank resume when you think about it. He looks like Opie on Andy Griffith. Now he's going to try to run it and thinks better of it. Steps out of bounds right in front of big number 11, who is a load. Devin Deal, who's really been playing well of late, the junior from El Paso, loss of two there.
Yeah, and how cool is it for Devin Deal, number 11, and Marcus Deal, number 95, to get the start today? Marcus Deal, because he's performed so well and kind of outperformed Mitchell, and then Devin Deal, Cooper McDonald's out, and he's performed well.
Yeah, that counts as a sack for Devin.
Man, his name is good, too, isn't
it? Sure does. Got to deal it.
Devin Deal, he spells it weird, but, you know, love it all the same.
Second and 12, Brooks wrapped up and corralled. Big-time tackle there from Osafa Mensah. Nana Osafa Mensah, that was just a big-time play against one of the best backs in the country.
Nana says, Nana, we're not going to give anything else to old Taj Brooks. A nice job, and you usually see Taj Brooks break those arm tackles, but Nana's so strong, and he gets a hold of him and slams him to the ground.
7 of 14 on third downs today, the Red Raiders. They go with 2 by 2, so 4 wide, and Brooks in the backfield.
And right now, Hammond has no incompletions.
It's Brooks on a stretch. Brooks inside the 10. See where they mark him out. It should be around the 6-yard line. Between the 6 and the 7, Austin Jordan, number 14, ushered him out. And it's going to be fourth down. Fourth down and about 2, a long 2 or maybe 3. Well, they're going to call it a long 1, but they're going to go for the field goal here.
How about our employees on the sideline just moving out of the way? Not getting run over by a talented running back like Brooks.
24 yards for Garcia. And Gino remains perfect, kicking them this season for the Red Raiders. Add to the tote board as Burkhart prepares. He's one of the stars of this game. This game turned on a sack and fumble, and then after it looked like TCU had stopped him, they went with a fake field goal, and he took it in. As you look at our Pacific Life game summary, speaking of, this is what we call a transition, Devin. Sponsored by Pacific Life, creating financial security for more than 160 years. Savion Williams had control of the first quarter. 34-yard jaunt, a 75-yard catch. This is it. And Burkhart takes it in. And then, in the second half, after the injury to Morton, here comes Hammond throwing to Coy Aiken.
And running
in for a touchdown himself. TCU gets an answer. And because they kept Texas Tech out of the end zone, they got a chance to make a move here and cut it to a one-score game, provided they get unleashed in this drive. Jack Besh gets a first down right in front of Macho Stevenson on the first play of it. Out to the 35-yard line, a gain of 10.
They certainly have to have urgency. And the thing is, they have the weapons and the quarterback to do it. They just have to make sure they protect the football.
Shadows have now come over Amon G. Carter Stadium. And here goes the outstanding Trent Battle. Trent Battle, the junior from Daphne, Alabama. He gets out ahead for a nice gain on first down. Pick up a 4, second down and 6.
Because of the turnovers and different things like that, they haven't really been able to get Trent Battle into the game as much as they probably wanted to. But I love that they're not abandoning the run game. As long as you get positive runs, it's cool to run the football at this stage of the game.
Trent's dad played in the big leagues, Allen Battle. And we got a marker down, pre-snap. Looks like another false start.
Yeah, right tackle flinched.
Might have been Whitfield, forced into duty over Nichols at the right tackle spot. Normally backs up Harris on the left side.
False start. Offense number 56, 5-yard penalty, second down.
Yep, that is a Ben Taylor Whitfield. Hard to miss him, 6'6", 315.
I love the big guys when they flinch and then they try to freeze. It's like, no, 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 we saw you. Everybody saw you. Yeah.
Out of the shotgun on second down. Hoover with plenty of time. Lets it fly. It is caught. It's inside the 15. It is Jack Besh.
Who better to go to than Besh? Safety comes out of the middle of the field, and Besh just sees green grass, and he turns on the Jets to run that football down in a perfect throw by quarterback Josh Hoover.
52 yards on that connection. Sonny told us it's what he does after the catch, which has separated him from the pack this season. On pace to easily be all Big 12. And probably some All-America mentions. This is just a thing of beauty.
Yeah, it is, really. And like I said, Hoover with a perfect pass. But this Besh is so impressive. He's like the perfect mix of a possession receiver, mm-hmm. but also a big play receiver, as you can see down the field there.
Let's go down to Josh. He's got more on Jack.
Well, I had a chance to talk with him this week, and we always hear guys say, you know, the key to success is being the last one in, doing the most reps. So I said, what does success look like for you? Well, he says, yeah, I do all that. I'm the last guy to leave at the end of the day. I do more reps. I get more reps in on the jugs machine, but also it's all about getting 1% better each and every day. If I do that when I go out on the field on Saturdays, it's going to show, and that's what we're seeing out there today from him.
He came into today with a stat line that was truly impressive, 42 catches, 748 yards and 7 touchdowns.
And they've got him one-on-one again right now. Yep. So I wouldn't be surprised if they don't give him another chance. If I'm Baskerville, you got to get over the top to help here.
Well, he has 4 receptions today for 77 yards, 62 of it right here on this drive.
Savion Williams back at quarterback.
Oh, they fake the reverse and dump it to the tight end, Dabney. And he slipped a little bit. Turf Monster got him. I'm sorry, that was Savion Williams who made the throw off of Hoover, and it was Rodgers on the receiving end.
Yeah,
it was
a lot of stuff going on there.
There was.
Yep. Wildcat handoff reverse back to Hoover.
Indeed.
And it was a lot for just a couple yards.
Absolutely. As your play-by-play man will attest, Savion gets it down to about the 2, maybe the 3. They'll mark him at the 3.
Dude, a guy this size with such acceleration and the ability to break tackles, it's just really impressive. He should be tackled in the backfield right here. He should be down, but no, he finds a way to get outside, trips a little bit, gets his balance, and then powers his way through for a first down.
And that's Rodriguez, a good tackler that missed him.
Yes, it was.
Hoover's pass, back shoulder, it's caught. It is touchdown, and it is Jack Besh. His 8th of the year.
We thought when he had the one-on-one a little bit ago, he would get the opportunity, but they wait here, give him the one-on-one, and it's just a fade route and a perfectly thrown back shoulder out to that third lane, away from the defender, and Besh with the strong hands makes the catch.
That's the young man, by the way, from Lafayette, Louisiana, down in the Acadianas.
Ineligible receiver downfield, number 5, number 0.
Oh, boy.
5-yard penalty. First touchdown.
Oh, boy.
Wow.
Wave it off, and Sonny is in disbelief.
Wow.
That was a late call. I mean, a very late call.
Yeah, I mean, we got to take a look to see how many guys are on the field, and if number zero is covered up, he cannot go out for a pass, and that is a heartbreaker. But
indeed.
You can't dwell on it. You cannot dwell on it. You have to move forward right here, and you still have one-on-ones across the field, and you've got number 88 to the bottom of your screen against a shorter defender.
Hoover again. Crossing pattern. End zone. Caught. Touchdown. It's a moot point now. It's Rodgers, the tight end.
Rodgers taketh away and maybe giveth back.
A junior from Sammamish, Washington, E.J. Rodgers.
He was legal that time, wasn't he, Tim?
Yeah, he was. Well, his lone career touchdown was against Texas Tech a year ago. And just his second reception all year, this year. And now Kyle Lemmerman, the freshman from Southlake, Texas, for the extra point. .842 left. And as we expected, it's a six-point game. And Eamon G. Carter is making some noise now. Well, booted a little bit by Rodgers, but he's going to bring it up anyway. And he finds just a little crack. He's mad at himself. Gets it out to the 25. Jacoby Williams on the return. Above and Beyond is sponsored by Jersey Mike's. Be a sub above.
Yeah, and it's Will Hammond, man. He has gone above and beyond the call of duty more than any backup is ever called to do, right? And you want a backup to come in and just preserve the lead, right? And kind of just not make mistakes. And he's come in and he's been electric. He's done an outstanding job. However, the biggest test comes now because TCU has cut this to a one-score lead, and he has an opportunity to try to put this game away, but he has to pick up first down after first down and eventually go put the ball in the end zone.
Oh, quick throw, and the turf monster absolutely gobbles up the receiver, Kelly. I thought maybe he had hurt himself, but he stumbled. Thankfully, he isn't injured. I thought for a minute he might have pulled a hamstring there as he stumbled, and that was just a clear case of the turf monster getting him. Nice gain, though. Second and four after the six-yard pickup. Brooks hammered at the line of scrimmage. Falls forward for maybe a yard. They'll need three on third down. Austin Jordan, 14, the first to get there. Big play here. Fans know it, too. Why not? Give it to your big time back and he'll get it for you. Now, when we had them against Washington State, Taj Brooks couldn't go, and boy, was it noticeable. Today, even though he's been keyed on and is not having a banner afternoon in yardage, it's winning time. And he's toting it big time, picking them up, putting them down, another first down. He's going to inch closer to 100 on this drive.
So good by the offensive lineman, double teaming to the second level and making sure they create a path. And I'm just telling you, you give this guy a little bit of daylight and he can burst through and make a play. That's why his kind of running style is not an issue. His patience, his ability to stand there, because his burst after a standstill is very impressive.
Jacoby Williams comes in for him. That pickup was for 12 yards. He's up to 98 on the day. Uh-oh. Hammond had a freshman moment there. The ball just slipped out of his hand as he was about to throw a little hitch out to Josh Kelly.
Wow.
I mean, that could have been devastating.
I couldn't agree more. I mean, he has what he wants, right? You got pressure coming in. He tries to go to the RPO, and there's nothing there. It just slips out of his hands. But good to have the wherewithal to get down on the ball, not try to pick it up and do something crazy. And that was almost a disaster for Texas Tech.
Can you imagine the adrenaline, though, going through that young man? And has been since he came out there to open the third quarter.
That's why it's so impressive. I've been in that position where you come in, the starter's hurt, and the starter has played well, and you're expected to perform. It's a lot of pressure on the road in an environment like this, not to mention everything is riding on this. You have everything to play for. If Texas Tech wins out, they get a chance to go play in the Big 12 championship and maybe the playoffs. So everything is on the shoulders of this true freshman quarterback.
Ames, Iowa is next on their schedule against undefeated Iowa State. Blitz up the middle, pass. Boy, that was dangerous. Aiken was in the neighborhood, but four, count them, four Horn Frogs were closer to it than Coy Aiken. And now you're backed up in a third and 17 situation.
Yeah, you got all the usual suspects in the area. OBI's door, you got Kamara, and you've got number two, Johnson. I mean, he was really lucky there that nothing bad happened. And listen to this crowd on third and long.
That was his first incomplete pass. Comes right back, zips it incomplete. Great defensive work by Canada, number seven, who was isolated with Aiken, mano a mano. Punt formation coming up.
Yeah, I mean, we talked about these defensive backs in position at every turn, and the ball thrown a little bit behind, but it wouldn't matter. Canada was there. And they call that glove technique, where you go in, you don't swat at the ball, you put that glove right in between to make sure the catch can't be made.
The son of Bucky, J.P. Richardson, waits inside his 20. The punt from Burgess is angling end over end inside the 10, and he's going to bring it back. Look out, trying to get to the boundary. Well, he managed to get something out of that. He was in a lot of danger. Backed up a little, but got it out. And this is their chance to get it. If Hoover can maintain the football and not turn it over. Quick hitch to Patterson. Texas Tech's defense tested and really has answered the bell today for their defensive coordinator, Tim DeRuiter. But he desperately needs one more stop.
Yeah, and for Josh Hoover, he's been in this situation before. In their season opener, he led a game-winning drive to beat Stanford. 34-27. The question is, can he do it again?
Second and five. Pressure up the gut. Looking for and finding a pair of eights. It's McAllister picking them up, putting them down. Touchdown, TCU. Yards to McAllister, their longest play of the year again. We've seen two of them today. Remember, Savion had a 75-yarder in the first quarter this afternoon.
The 6'4", 205-pound transfer from Boise State has been chomping at the bit to make a play. He goes on the go route, a perfect back shoulder, and the rest is all him. He is striking out down the sideline for a touchdown! Unbelievable!
He looked like Quentin Johnston on that play. He looked like the kid Duggan used to find in 2022. Who would become a first pick. That was just beautifully done. Look at him create the space.
Oh, yeah, and just before the play, I said, could Josh Hoover do it again? Didn't anticipate that it'll be a one-play drive, and obviously there's still time to go, but Josh Hoover, he's had the ball bounce in a bad way early in this game. 21 of 32, 344 yards, and count them, 1, 2, 3 touchdown, with the latest being that long one to McAllister.
We felt coming into today's game in the Big 12 that this would be a season-defining game for either team. All right, TCU's got a couple of conference losses, but they can win every game they've got left on their schedule. Now, they can also lose them. And this kick is going to go out of bounds, which gives Texas Tech the ball at the 35. But Iowa State is next up for Texas Tech. They've only got the one conference loss.
Free kick out of bounds on the kicking team. The ball will be placed at the 35-yard line.
I don't get it.
First down.
And that, that means that there's a lot at stake. A lot at stake for these teams in the remaining 5 minutes.
Tim, you have such an amazing play. Emotions all through the stadium. And then you kick the ball out of bounds. Yeah. I never understand it. Don't get it. There's no win. There's no excuse.
The plight of Will Hammond. Had his first freshman hiccup, really, on that third down ball. It just slipped out of his grasp. Now they hand it off to Brooks, who's now over 100 yards with that six-yard gallop. That'll get him to 104.
One thing is for certain. I don't think Texas Tech is going to panic one bit. Kittley understands that with 4 minutes and 50 seconds to go, they're in a perfect position. Well, they can run the ball. They can throw the ball. They can play this game exactly how they want it. They don't have to feel pressed at all.
If anything, you want to sustain a drive. You'd rather not leave them much clock. And Brooks, again, will keep the clock ticking as he keeps on moving. This time past the 45 to the 47. Brooks has now secured his 19th career 100-yard-plus game. All seven games this year, too.
And if you're Texas Tech, you have to know the best thing you can do is bleed this entire clock out. Like you talked about, you don't want to give TCU and this crowd an opportunity to hold the ball away from you. You want to try and use as much clock as possible before you even get points.
Yeah, both coordinators have to be keeping that in mind. Streaking, Douglas overthrown. He had some help over the top.
Yeah.
Did the corner. Abe Kamara was there along with LaMarion James.
And I'll count that as Hammond's second freshman mistake. He's got safety help over the top, and it's a double move. And as a young guy, you want to throw it. You just watched your opposition throw that long pass for a touchdown. You want to respond, but he has to know there. It isn't there. Don't throw it. Check it down or use your legs that have been valuable for you to this point in the game.
Well, he's missed his last three. He was 9 of 9 to start. Brooks. Nice maneuver on Kamara's part. He's been outstanding, that kid. And so is Channing Canada, number 7. Kamara and Channing Canada have been tremendous in run support. Third down, 7. What will Zach Kittley dial up?
It looks like it's going to be zero coverage, right, with no safety back. If they don't change, you've got one-on-ones all across the field. They change now.
Brooks twisting and turning and falling. Shy of the 45 of TCU, Zachary Chapman 42.
And it looks like they're going to go fast. That looks like a call that you anticipate that you're going to go 4 downs and try to get the first down if you don't get it on that 3rd down, and that's what they're going to do.
Could be the game. May not be, but could be. Hammond under pressure. Markers down. We could have a false start as he goes to the 40. I don't see a flag. I thought for a moment.
Yeah.
We saw premature movement, but no flag.
There was premature movement, but they would have stopped the play completely.
Boy.
They let it go.
And
like I talked about, don't force anything. Use your legs that have been valuable for you, and the young freshman does that for a 1st down.
Well, they were 2 out of 2 now on 4th downs. Boy, I absolutely thought I saw premature movement. Jacoby Williams now checks in for Brooks. 1st down at the TCU 40. Williams tries to bounce outside, but Deal would have nothing to do with it. Caleb Fox, number 90, the first to make contact. Here's the previous play. Now, take a look at this.
Yeah, it's close.
Oh,
it's close. I think that they may have gotten it right. At the exact same time. I don't think that they have premature movement.
Yep.
And I think that's a good call by the referees.
At first glance, no call. In real time, it looked like the right tackle did move.
Yeah, which makes it more impressive, right?
Absolutely. Good no call by the officials. Man, how much fun is this, huh?
Oh, yeah. We've arrived at the 2-minute timeout, and we've got more football on the side, baby.
Just another day in the Big 12 Conference.
He's two out of two between 40 and 49. Quick pitch towards the boundary. Jacoby Williams down the sideline and knocked out of bounds. First down inside the 30-yard line, shoved out by Travis Brunton.
And it's his speed. His speed is the reason why he captures the edge. TCU did a nice job of having guys out there, but he's just so fast. He gets around with those pullers and gets right through. I mean, unbelievable by the young freshman, Williams.
Well, at what point, if you're TCU, do you start thinking about timeouts? Because you want to have some time left after they score. Brooks remains the setback. Eight carries for 42 and counting after this run by Brooks inside the 30 to about the 27-yard line. And they are going to take a timeout. I think it might be Texas Tech that's taking this timeout. And it is a 30-second timeout. TCU took it. So,
yeah,
just as I suggested, they need to start taking those timeouts.
Yeah, it feels to me, and I'm sure Slaney Dykes felt the same way, that Texas Tech is feeling like they're in good position and they can make a field goal. And like I talked about, they want to run all the time off the clock, right? So if you're TCU, you got to play for maybe they make the field goal, and you got to make sure you have some time left to drive down the field and get a field goal of your own.
And you've got a kicker that's never missed this year. I mean, Garcia's perfect.
Oh, that sounds like an announcer's jinx that I've ever heard.
Well, got to give it. Sorry. Bottom of the ninth, he's working on a no-no. I'm sorry. I got to mention it. Reese Burkhart has missed. Of course, he's the kicker from distance who handles the kickoffs. Also had the fake field goal for the touchdown earlier. Second down and seven. Out of the shotgun. It's Brooks, and he's wrapped up at the line, maybe behind the line. Could have lost a yard on that play. And it's Caleb Alarmzor that made that stop, and a timeout is taken. Well, last night, Freddie Freeman's walk-off grand slam lit up Los Angeles. And Aaron Judge getting a little BP. There's Muncy. The Dodgers grabbing that opening game of the World Series. There's Dave Winfield. Remember when his contract was outlandish when Steinbrenner gave it to him? Not so much now. Judge and the Yankees will look to bounce back in game two. That's coming up next right here on Fox. Chatting it up with Mookie there.
Yeah, Mookie Betts, one of the best athletes this world has to offer, right? I mean, he probably could step on a football field and do well, and they intentionally walk him, and then Freeman comes and knocks it out of the park. He goes yard. I love it.
As a left-handed hitter, though, you can't throw any good left-hander in that situation a heater on the inside half of the plate. You can't. Here's the big play for our game, third and seven. Hammond's going to keep it. A little quarterback counter, and he runs right into a roadblock. Hakeem Ojulaya. Hakeem Ojulaya.
They're fighting as if the ball came out.
Yeah, they are. And number 93 made a big hit. Boy, that is a mammoth hit that he made. Did they get a recovery? Yes,
goodness, they
did. It's Deal on top of it. Deal comes away with a late recovery. Oh, my goodness.
They haven't made a clear decision
just
yet.
No, they have not.
The ruling on the field is the runner is down prior to the ball coming loose. Fourth down.
Oh, boy.
But the thing is, you can go back and look at this if there's a clear recovery on replay.
You can.
And the hit was hard enough that the ball
sure
could have been jarred loose. He spins. Oh, the ball is out.
Yeah.
The ball is out, and if it's a clear recovery.
The ruling on the field is under further review.
Yeah. Well, the ball is out.
That's TCU football.
And
if they've got TCU with a clear recovery, that's TCU football.
And that's Marcus Deal on top of it, 95. It should be Horned Frog's ball. Talk about heartbreak.
93, 6'2", 320 pounds. Any true freshmen that are thinking about playing college football, don't spin back into that.
By the way, the question will come, why not give it to Taj Brooks? A sure-handed running back. You've got a freshman running a counter, a quarterback counter,
and he gets leveled by a 315-pound lineman.
Yeah, that's true.
But there's nothing wrong with this hit. It's a great hit, a legal hit, but the kind of powerful hit in the chest that is going to knock that ball free.
And Hammond has great ball security. And the thing is, for me, Tim, I don't want to question Kittley's call to keep the ball in the young guy's hands. And the reason is he's played well.
I'm with you.
Remember, they pick up big yardage by putting that ball in the hands of another freshman, Jacoby Williams, right? So they're playing the game the way they're playing it. And it's just – it's very unfortunate. He spins back into a 320-pound man,
really
and he has ball security, and the ball comes out. And like I said, I think this is going to be TCU football, and Texas Tech still has three timeouts, though, right? This game is not over by any stretch of the imagination, even if TCU has the football.
Yeah, remember, it was TCU taking those timeouts to preserve time, presuming, of course, they had a field goal that went in, and they were down by two. Now, Texas Tech has all of its timeouts. And, you know, you think about, do the math on that. You're looking at maybe 45 seconds or so left in the game if they get a three and out and force a punt. So, we are not yet done. Marcus Deal, that is the freshman brother of Devin Deal out of El Paso, Texas. He's clearly got the ball. And they've got to overturn this. No way the ball could have been blown dead. He wasn't even close to the ground when the ball came free. And remember, Deal is the guy who both Sonny and Avalo said.
After further review, the ball was fumbled, recovered by the defense at the 27-yard line. Over TCU ball, first down. The timer, please reset the game clock to 1:38.
Both Andy Avalos, the defensive coordinator, and Sonny said that the guy that had made the most progress on TCU's defense was Marcus Deal. And he made a difference on that play after the hit by 93 Ajulea, Hakeem Ajulea. And he's the third team nose that made that hit.
I mean, this has been a game of ebbs and flows. I mean, this is football. The first quarter, all TCU. The second quarter, all Texas Tech. The third quarter, a little mix of both. The fourth quarter, they battle, trade punches, and then that big turnover for TCU. TCU's lost turnover battle 3-1, but got the biggest one of the game.
No doubt about it.
Like we talked about, the game is not over. With three timeouts for Texas Tech, if they get a stop here, the ball will be punted away. They will have a chance. Not a lot of time, but they'll have a chance.
Again, as we said, if you calculate plays on average, how long they take, and you get a stop, the potential of Texas Tech using all three of their timeouts and getting the ball back with 45 or fewer seconds exists. Dominic Johnson, number 20, a big back, is in there flanking Savion Williams, who's going to run Wildcat again. That's a good idea. Let him run it and get you 10, and then some. Pretty good idea there. A.J. McCarty, the nickelback, comes up. Move the sticks. It's a first down. So that takes some of that time that we were anticipating off the clock.
And the thing here is, now Texas Tech has to take a timeout so they don't lose so much time. And so the clock restarts. So now you're essentially starting this drive with just two timeouts.
Yep.
And when it gets to a third or a fourth down, you won't be able to stop the clock, and the clock would continue to run.
Right. I mean, that what a smooth move by putting Savion in at the Wildcat there.
I mean, they kind of figured him out in the middle of this game. But
sure did.
Here in winning time, similar to Taj Brooks, they get him the ball in the Wildcat, and he picks up 10.
All right, I want to go back to the big games in the Big 12 and what's at stake here. Texas Tech was eyeing an opportunity to go up against Iowa State with only one conference loss. That may not happen now. TCU does have the two conference losses, but hey, in this league, even if you're undefeated, and BYU's leading big today, and of course Iowa State's got their game yet to come. BYU up big on UCF. Cincinnati's playing at Colorado later tonight, but you figure that the chances of any one of these teams dropping a couple of games in the month of November is pretty good.
Yeah.
So just keep on playing in this league.
for TCU, you have to remember, ball security is at a premium.
Yep.
Two hands on the football. There's no way you can give this football back.
Wrapped up, but then keeps his legs going. That, again, big number 17, Trent Battle.
Yeah, love the run, love the tough, trying to fight for extra yards. With Texas Tech taking another timeout. I love that for Battle, but I don't love one hand on the ball, right? I mean, just look at how you got the football. Great ball security by Hammond, and he's hit right on it, and the ball comes loose, right? So if I'm a runner for TCU, I'm going to have two hands on the ball in traffic at all times and sacrifice fighting for yards for ball security.
And again, I go back to the big, big picture here, okay? Kansas is at Kansas State tonight. These are the standings. BYU still got a lot left. So does Iowa State within the league. These are the conference standings. And, of course, both of these teams are in the top 15, Iowa State in the top 10. Kansas State very much in the mix. Texas Tech was hoping to be. This could be a devastating loss for them. Lots of big games left to be played in this conference, and I think it's easily the most competitive in the country. Bottom to top, there are no easy outs in this league. Second and 12. Savion back in the Wildcat again, just looking to run clock. Texas Tech right on top of him. Need to let go and let the whistle stop. Third down coming and a timeout taken. And Savion's still on the deck.
Texas Tech has called their third and final timeout of the half.
He's going to
set the game clock to 1 minute and 20 seconds.
He's going to get home to his bed and have a nice sleep.
So, 1 point game, third and 13. And as you add up the number, and how much time will go off the clock on a play. That was a quick first down that Savion got them, which cost really Texas Tech a timeout. But if they can stop them right here, Devin, should have somewhere in the neighborhood of 30 to 35 seconds left
to
get the ball back.
This is where you hope you have a great weapon at the punter position. And remember, the punting has not been good. For TCU.
One went for 21 yards.
Yeah, shanked it, and right before that, right, it was only 32 yards, right? So, and those balls went out of bounds quickly and were stopped dead quickly, right? So, even though the clock would be running on fourth down, they have to make sure they get a good punt with good hang time to take as much time off the clock as they can.
Savion's going to take this out of the Wildcat again. Look at him. Gets it up to the 40, and that... It's more a case of just making sure the clock keeps running. That's the big deal here.
Yeah.
And it does. A minute and change now. You see the play clock. How much time is left? It'll be right around 35 seconds when Texas Tech gets the ball back.
Yeah, and it looks like Sonny Dice is going to wait until the clock gets down to zeros on the play clock, call timeout, and then he has to give those reminders to his team. Hey, make sure that we max protect. Make sure that we get this punt off. Because the thing that could be disastrous is a block punt, and we've seen it get close early in this game. So I love what he's doing here. Readjust, right? Talk to your team. Make sure they know the circumstance so you can get this ball punted away and walk out with a win.
And for you Red Raiders fans that are wondering about the potential of getting it back, here comes a call from the referee.
35.
It was just adjusting the clock. That's all that was. So the timeout was taken, and 34 seconds remain. And you feel for this young man, Will Hammond, but he was perfect. 9 out of 9, feeling fine. That pass to Aiken was on his very first drive. Then his second drive, he takes it in himself on a beautiful zone read. And then he was running quarterback counters, and then all of a sudden, ball slips out of his hand on one drive.
Yep.
And then on another, this happens. 93 with the hit, 95 with the recovery, and his world turned upside down. Something to think about. Garcia, even though 49 is his longest, he did hit a 59-yarder while playing at Houston Baptist. Fair catch by Brown. He's got it at the 21. So, 29 seconds left. Garcia, 45, in the FBS is his longest. But while at Houston Baptist in the FCS against Southeast Louisiana down in Hammond, just outside Baton Rouge, he hit a 59-yarder. So you're thinking reasonably they need to get somewhere around the 40 at least, the 40 of TCU at the very least, to even have a chance. No timeouts left. Everything's got to be toward the boundary or a first down down the field and something quick. Hammond in some trouble. Unloads it towards Brooks. It's incomplete.
You're going to see very soft coverage from TCU, making sure. And I wouldn't be surprised if Andy Avalos doesn't even show that it's not soft, just to get the young quarterback to see a picture that he doesn't recognize and then get into that soft, deep half coverage with the guy in the middle as well.
He needs about 35 to 40 more yards to get off a 55-yard field goal try. Letting it fly for Aiken. He got a hand on it, but it falls incomplete. Canada step for step with Coy Aiken.
That is so good by Channing Canada, because even though in the NFL the pass interference penalty is much worse, you'll still get a free 15 yards. He does a nice job of running with Aiken and then looking back to find the ball. He looks over his left shoulder and then over his right shoulder, so there's no chance of a flag for pass interference.
Third and 10. Trips to the top. Hammond giving himself some room. Now decides to run it. Hammered again up at the 31-yard line. And unfortunately, the clock's going to continue to run.
Inbounds.
He did not get the first down. We got a marker down, so hold everything. Devin Deal hammered him there. See who this flag is against. The penalty.
The one thing you can't
marker
do is
down.
Spin back inbounds.
They're going to call a personal foul here, I think. They may be ready to call a personal foul on TCU. I think that's what this discussion is about.
Holding, offense number 79.
Oh.
10-yard penalty, third down.
Wow, I thought they might hit up. It looked like TCU looked like they were, are you going to get us for this hit?
No, there's no chance of that, but yep. I think that comes with a 10-second runoff, and they don't have a timeout because the clock was running when that penalty happens. Maybe not, but I thought that was the rule where if the clock is running, you have a penalty, it's a 10-second runoff unless you have a timeout to use, and they do not.
All right, so no 10-second runoff here, so they get one play on fourth down. I want to thank everyone involved, Jacob Jolivet. Jake does a wonderful job, our producer, director, Dustin Denti, all of our crew here in the booth today. We'll be taking you directly to our World Series pregame through a commercial after this play. They're going to throw a little soccer play at us, and it's going to end right here. But you got to get a tackle, or he's going to keep on throwing it. Now it's on the ground, and TCU secures the win. They move to 5-3, 2-2 in the Big 12. Texas Tech to 5-3, 3-2 in conference play. For Devin Gardner,